Welcome. We will call this meeting to order. This is the September 6th meeting of the Yellow Springs Village Council. Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yes, Wintrow.
Here.
Here.
Sims.
Here.
Queen.
Here.
Hemphill.
Here.
Also present are Village Manager Patty Bates, Assistant Village Manager Melissa Van Zant, Chief of Police Dave Hale, and Village Solicitor Chris Conner.
Well, to start out, we have a great announcement and a great event, and that's going to be the swearing-in of a new police officer. And Patty Bates will be doing that. And it will be Police Officer Allison Sarber. I hope I said that correctly.
Allison, if you will, please raise your right hand and repeat after me. I state your name.
Hi, Allison Sarber.
Do solemnly swear or affirm.
Do solemnly swear or affirm.
That I will support the Constitution and laws of the United States of America.
That I will support the Constitution and laws of the United States of America.
The Constitution and laws of the State of Ohio.
The Constitution and laws of the State of Ohio.
And the laws and ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio.
And the laws and ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio.
And I will discharge the duties.
And I will discharge the duties.
Of the office of police officer.
Of the office of police officer.
To which I have been appointed.
To which I have been appointed.
To the best of my ability.
To the best of my ability. Thank you.
You want to take a couple of pictures?
Yes.
Sorry, Allison.
We'd like to congratulate you, Officer Sarber. Thank you, and welcome aboard.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Nice to meet you.
Do you should Sergeant Knapp take?
We'll take a picture together. Why not?
Any family friends want to join her? Oh, good.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you all for coming, and this is great for us. We appreciate it.
It's one of my favorite
heading off
things.
To work?
Not today.
Okay.
We gave her the day off.
Thank you. Nice
Thanks.
To see you all. Other announcements? I've got announcements about a bunch of events coming up this weekend, as does Brian. Anything else anybody would like to announce?
I would.
I've got some announcements, but you may cover them.
Well,
see.
Go ahead.
I think most of the public is aware that school has started, and I've been working with Jason and Sergeant Watson. And looking at trying to improve the traffic on West South College. For those of you who are not aware, when our kids come to school, the sun is shining right up West South College, practically blinding the people that are heading east. We tried to put a speed sign up, but they have to get that fixed. But we're working on some things that we hope that will make it safer, especially for the students that are riding their bikes. It's approximately 100 students that ride their bikes daily to and from school. Plus, we have parents taking their kids to school. So we are working on trying to make that route safer.
And are things working at Mills Lawn? Is the process at Mills Lawn safe?
Not sure with Mills Lawn.
Chief has been
Chief
out
might
there.
Be able to address that one.
It's pretty much the way it has been, and we don't see any big problems. Even myself, or patrol officers usually there in the mornings to some degree, sometimes out actually greeting the children. They're usually that, if not patrolling that area, watching the four-way stops, the stop signs, etc. I know Sergeant Watson likes to go to the crosswalk in Limestone quite often, so we're hitting those places and have not seen anything that raises huge concerns.
Okay, thank you.
But I would like to again remind those that are driving that area, the speed limit is 25. And we are seeing folks driving much faster than 25 up and down there. So again, we just have to obey the signs and so forth so we can, until we can make some changes.
Are you going to talk about reunion?
Yeah, I wanted to mention
okay,
a couple
of
things. Yeah, there's a lot going on in town this weekend, a lot. So if you're unaware, there's more than enough to keep people having fun all weekend. One of the things is the Antioch College Alumni Reunion, and they are celebrating their theater, and there's a lot of, they're celebrating their alumni performers. So I'm sure it'll all be in the newspaper, but there's a lot of activities going on, including classes that are being taught, I know, by dancers, alumni dancers.
Which particular dancer?
And one in particular that I happen to know. But, well, my daughter, but also I know Demi Reber, who, you know, taught at Antioch, and it just sounds like there's going to be a lot going on that's going to be really fun and of interest to a lot of people. And then, at the same time, AACW Blues Fest is happening, and we gave them permission on Saturday night to go past the 10 o'clock noise ordinance time to have performing going on until 11 p.m. And Saturday afternoon, is it at 3 o'clock?
3 o'clock.
Here, I imagine it's going to be outside, mm-hmm. out front, will be a memorial service for Faith Patterson, who was an important key person who kept the AACW alive and well in bringing these wonderful blues festivals to us every year. So her daughter's been working hard to celebrate her mom's life. So for those who can come, that would be great. And I offered to try to help find someone who could help tape the memorial service. So I'm still looking, so if there's anybody who hears this and wants to give me a call, I just was trying to help Karen a little bit. By trying to identify someone who could help with that. And the Thursday evening, the AACW is sponsoring a gospel event at the Presbyterian Church. So.
And Friday is Blues and Poems.
Right, at the Emporium.
At Emporium, yeah.
Yeah, and there's also an event on Sunday to wrap things up at the Coretta Scott King Center. So it's going to be a great 4 days.
And the World House Choir is singing on Wednesday at the Presbyterian Church, I think, evening.
I thought Friday, too.
Wednesday and Friday?
At 7.
Are both venues at the Presbyterian Church?
Wednesday and Friday are both at Presby, right?
And then I think they perform in Dayton also,
and
but I'm not
Urbana
sure when.
Right. Ceremony in Urbana.
And then also happening this weekend, Cyclops Fest is at Mills Lawn. That's an arts and crafts festival. There will be food trucks, and Yellow Springs Brewery will be there. That's from 9 to 6. Again, it's at Mills Lawn. It used to be here, but it's been moved to Mills Lawn. The 9/11 stair climb, Yellow Springs 9/11 stair climb being sponsored and done by Miami Township Fire and Rescue. I think that there's still an opportunity for teams to join, and if you're not interested in actually doing the climb, I'm sure that they would appreciate your donation. Donna Margarota's is having their first anniversary event that evening also. And I have a feeling the sunflowers will still be blooming. So there will be lots of people in town, I have a feeling, the entire weekend. And for all of those events, and obviously we have all the folks coming in for reunion, I think that there are over 200 people from outside, not just community members. So 200 plus all of the community members that will be attending. So lots of folks. Anything else?
Well, I'll just add, speaking of sunflowers, on September 16th, right? Yep, September 16th is the Tecumseh Land Trust's annual harvest auction, which the village was also able to give a small sponsorship to. So lots of great things happening.
Great. Anything else before we move on? Next is the consent agenda. We have the minutes of August 15th regular meeting, and Resolution 2016-46, certifying the amounts and rates for the 2017 tax year. Can I get a motion?
Can I just say, I have made the correction, which was pointed out to me, that I put in the vote incorrectly on the minutes. That has been corrected for one of the resolutions.
Okay.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Review of the agenda. Is there anything that we need to change, add, or remove from the agenda?
Are we doing something with Nia Stewart?
Oh, yes. Sorry. Nia Stewart, nomination for the Justice System Task Force. I thought it was already on the agenda.
Oh, yeah, it is. It's under old business, yeah.
Yeah.
Cool.
Okay, so Brian, will you review the petitions and communications?
Yes, so there was a sustainability report from AMP, which is our electric provider. There's only hard copies of those on the table. We had a letter from Mark Heiss highlighting the importance of street fair for small businesses, as well as his wife Robin Heiss, who's talked about street fair being important for nonprofits. Alexandra Scott from the Yellow Springs Chamber talking about a variety of things related to economic community development for street fair. And also Molly Lundy sort of generally talking about the importance of the village sponsoring events. A letter that we had referenced at the last meeting from a group of local concerned citizens talking about ideas for how to improve our local policing, and a clarification from John Gudgel that this is initiative from the pastor of the First Baptist Church in town, and also clarifying that this group wants to work in complement with our Justice Task Force. Beverly Logan.
Yeah, may I say something
please?
In regard to that? So Judith and I met and felt like we would send that letter to the Justice Task Force.
Great.
That Pastor Randolph and other people.
Thank you.
I was going to say, I don't know if this is the pastor. I didn't know if people knew who he was, but yeah.
Thank
Good
you.
To see you.
Beverly Logan submitted an email that talked about the timing of the meeting for the CBE and that it was surprising. And we got a station manager report from Susan Gartner right behind the camera talking about some of the movements towards making the station 21st century, bringing us into the new age. And in particular, that means setting up a platform for live streaming of meetings, so that you do not have to be a Time Warner subscriber to watch the meetings live. We also had a few other things. There is a community baby shower being sponsored by the Greene County Public Health District. And this is basically for new mothers and expectant mothers to learn more about best practices for childcare. That is happening on September 24th at the United Methodist Church in Xenia. Very exciting, the City of Springfield will be having the ribbon cutting this Friday at 2 p.m. for the connector that will continue the Little Miami Scenic Trail. So this is the trail that goes through Yellow Springs, and it will get you all the way to Bell Fountain. I actually rode that trail on Friday,
was it complete?
The new,
because it hasn't been.
I did not, the connector was not open yet.
Okay.
I did eye it very jealously, but I'm ready to ride it. And we also had the mayor's monthly report in the packet, and I think that's everything.
Great, thank you. Next, moving on to public hearings and legislation. First, we have a number of zoning appeal or zoning ordinances changes. I will have Judy read them in by title only, and then we will have probably Patty do a brief explanation. Judy?
Yeah, this is Ordinance 2016-17, which is repealing Section 1262.08 specific requirements of the codified ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and enacting new Section 1262.08 specific requirements, which is adding mobile food trucks to the I-1 and correcting a typographical error.
Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Patty?
The first one is a simple oversight in the code. There are minutes from June the 12th, 2013, showing that food trucks are supposed to be allowed as a conditional use in both the I-1 and I-2 zones. However, in the code, they are listed only in the I-2 zone. So this just corrects the oversight and allows food trucks as a conditional use in both the I-1 and I-2 zones.
Okay. And what's the typographical?
Is that the I-1 was left out?
Oh, okay. Okay. Any questions or comments from council? Questions or comments from citizens? Seeing and hearing none, we will have two readings for this. Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yes. Hempfling?
Yes.
McQueen?
Yes.
Sims?
Yes.
Hausch?
Yes.
Wintrow?
Yes. Next one?
The next one is 2016-18, repealing Section 1248.03, spatial requirements of the codified ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and enacting new Section 1248.03, spatial requirements, correcting an erroneous density maximum of 14 units per acre in the RB to a maximum of 8 units per acre in RB.
Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Patty?
Again, another typographical error. The moderate density residential zoning district is supposed to allow up to 8 units per acre. It does say 8 in one place. However, in a second place, it says 14. So this is simply to correct that typographical error from 14 back to the 8 that it is supposed to be in a moderate density residential zone.
Okay.
And 14 is the number of units in residence C.
Correct, in high Correct. Density mm-hmm. zones.
Any other comments or questions from citizen or from council citizens? Bring it back to the table. Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yes. McQueen?
Yes.
Hausch?
Yes.
Hempfling?
Yes.
Sims?
Yes.
Wintrow?
Yes.
Okay,
next.
This is 2016-19, repealing Section 1258.01 district uses of the codified ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and enacting new Section 1258.01 district uses. This is adding mobile food trucks to the EI. Am I right? EI?
Mm-hmm.
Zoning
mm-hmm.
district.
Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Again, we have minutes from July 10th, 2013. Where Judith actually introduced the request from Antioch University to have food trucks in the EI zone, which is what Antioch itself is considered. It was left out, unfortunately, in the zoning code, and so it just needs to be inserted into the proper place in that section.
Okay. And I think that would be EI for Antioch College property and Antioch University.
That's
property.
Correct.
Okay. Any comments or questions? Citizens, okay. Judy?
Hausch?
Yes.
Hempfling?
Yes.
McQueen?
Yes.
Sims?
Yes.
Wintrow?
Yes. One more.
The last one is 2016-20, repealing appendix zoning map in Title IV zoning of the codified ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and enacting new appendix zoning map. This is correcting a typographical error to list educational institution correctly as EI.
Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Okay, that's pretty much of an explanation.
I was going to say, Judy pretty much just explained that one. It needs to be EI instead of E1.
Right. Any comments or questions, council, citizens? Judy?
Oh, I'm sorry, that rule thing. Sims?
Yes.
Hausch?
Yes.
McQueen?
Yes.
Hempfling?
Yes.
Wintrow?
Yes. The next is Ordinance 2016-21. Let's read it in by title only, but then we'll take the time to have Melissa do an explanation.
This is the 2016 Supplemental Appropriations and Declaring an Emergency, Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio.
Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Melissa?
Okay, so what you have in front of you are supplemental spending to the original budget, which was passed back in December of last year. Most of the things that you'll find on here aren't very significant individually to speak of. A lot of them were just little loose ends that just needed to be tied together before the end of the year, which I try to do this at least twice a year, once towards the middle of the year and once towards the end of the year. So if we take a look at the general fund, our current approved budget was $3,306,664, and the supplements total up to $114,150 for a total amended budget of $3,420,814. And just to put that into perspective, the projected original deficit for the general fund was set to be $306,000 when this budget was passed. The new projected budget with the supplemental appropriation, the deficit is only supposed to be $61,000. And that would still allow our reserves to stay $700,000 above the minimum range, which I like to see them at. If we move on to the second section, which is the special revenue funds, the ODOT Safe Routes to School, let me go ahead and read the total on this. It was, the original budget was $1,328,730. The supplements add up to $120,325 for a grand total of $1,449,055. I went ahead and stuck in the ODOT Safe Routes to School, even though some of the expenditures are going to happen this year. I just went ahead and put the entire total in there in case we need to open up purchase orders for next year when we expect, hopefully, construction to start on that project. So this is money that we knew that we were going to spend for quite some time, but wasn't appropriated because it was kind of a moving target in terms of the project date. Parks and Recreation, $29,200. Some of that is the new playground equipment, and then some renovations to the building and a new boiler that had went out. And then that's about it for special revenue funds. And then when it comes to the third section, or actually section five as it's referred to in the ordinance, for the enterprise funds, the original budget was $6,428,322. The appropriations are $60,000 in anticipation of the resolution that will be read here shortly in regards to the new utility billing software, bringing the total for the enterprise fund appropriations to $6,488,322. There's also a supplemental appropriation worksheet that was put in the packet, which outlines each of the lines, what the appropriations were for and the account that they were going in, to be very transparent about that. When it comes to the bottom line impact, the special revenue funds, it wasn't a huge impact since the special revenue funds are directly funded by the general fund, and those funds are coming in under budget. The enterprise funds, the electric was deficit spending this year, but it's set to deficit spend less than anticipated, even with the supplemental appropriation in front of us. And then with water and sewer, both of those funds were to be in the black, including after these extra $20,000 out of each of those funds. So I will take any questions.
And would you also mention the capital project that was also supplement?
Yes, that small one that snuck in. Section four, which is the capital project fund appropriations, the library roof that was done, I think it was last year at this point, there was a little bit that was left out there that was actually expended after the purchase order was closed. So then we had to reopen up the purchase order, and since the purchase order was closed, it had to be a supplemental appropriation, even though it was a dollar amount that was already approved as part of that project, and it was not anything additional. So it was just an oversight where the purchase order was closed before the final check was cut for that completion of that project.
Okay.
So I'll take any questions.
So the all of the Safe Routes to School, we will be budgeting for all of those expenses, but you'll also have in our revenues, you'll have the offsetting income that we're getting.
Correct.
For reimbursement.
And yes, and right now we're paying for the consulting part of it. So the construction is going to be the next part, but since we're kind of unsure as to when exactly those expenditures are going to occur, the purchase orders need to be opened. I just wanted to go ahead and have that earmarked just in case.
Well, my question was kind of related. So the $61,000 deficit that you projected, does that include the $90,000 that we're paying up front for Safe Routes to School? That will be reimbursed, or?
The $61,000, that would be in the general fund. So, no, that wasn't, I didn't include that in that projection, because at the end of the day, it's going to be
balance
net zero.
Out. Mm-hmm. Okay.
I wasn't here for the whole budget process last year, but I didn't understand what you said there. You said we had a deficit projection of $306,000 in the general fund, but it's now $61,000, but we're adding a supplemental amount of $114,000, so I'm confused.
Yes, the original projected deficit was $306,000, and actually with the, I have the general fund budget ready, which is going to be presented at the very next meeting, and without the supplement, the projection for the general fund, let's see, it's set to be $61,000, but everything that was incorporated into the general fund as part of the supplemental appropriation was money that was all basically already spent. None of it has been extra. So it was all expenditures that I didn't anticipate or budget for. A lot of it was legal expenses that have already occurred. Mm-hmm. So all of it has already been taken into consideration because it was already money that we had to spend. So it's just allocating it appropriately to the lines that it needed to go towards.
So I assume that the reason why we're not having the $300,000 deficit is because either income has been greater or expenses have been less than originally projected. Is that?
Yes, it's mostly attributed to the expense side. Our revenues are up only about $61,000 over projected. So the revenues are up, but they're up only slightly. So the majority of that savings is as a result of just being fiscally responsible and not spending as much as what we were projected.
On other items.
Mm-hmm. Correct.
Okay. Any other comments or questions? This is an emergency, meaning we'll only have one reading, so I'll open the public hearing for public comment. Seeing and hearing none, I'll come back to council table. Are we ready to take the vote? Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yes. Humphrey?
Yes.
Sims?
Yes.
McQueen?
Yes.
Hausch?
Yes.
Wintrow?
Yes. Next is resolution 2016-47, title only.
Yes, this is authorizing the village manager to enter into a contract with Creative Microsystems Incorporated for utility billing software services.
Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Melissa?
Okay, so this resolution is for us to enter into a contract with a new utility billing provider. There are very few utility billing providers that are able to meet our needs. With us having an electric utility, it really narrows the options in the pool. So what I did was I had there are a number of different survey resources within the state with colleagues of mine where you can ask questions, and I put out there a question to see what other people used in terms of utility billing software companies, and there were two front runners in terms of what everybody in Ohio uses. And one of them is the current billing company that we are using, and the second is the one that I'm requesting that we enter into contract in order to switch to. We did research and checked references on this company. We had them come out and do a demo, and this software is light years ahead of the one that we currently use. Just the reporting capabilities alone are worth switching to. But with all of the changes that we've made in our utility billing system, it's definitely no secret that we've had a lot of issues. It's been very frustrating for myself and the staff, as well as the customers, to try to explain some of the strange glitches that have occurred on the back end of us trying to make positive changes in terms of changing rate structures, changing out meters, just the system that we currently have is not capable of making the changes that we need to bring ourselves up to speed. So this is a resolution to ask that we enter into contract. The total price is $59,140, which includes the first year of service, the complete conversion, all the implementation and training. And just to kind of put that in perspective, the upfront costs are quite a bit in order to be able to transition, just because of the amount of data and time and care that it takes to convert, which is probably going to take us approximately 6 months in order to be up and running on the new software. And in the long run, this software on an annual basis is about $2,500 cheaper than the one that we are currently with. So it's about two-thirds of the price of what we're already paying. So just alone, the confidence that I think that we're going to have in this new company is totally, totally worth it. So I'll be happy to answer any questions anybody has.
What do you anticipate? I mean, after, you know, in the midst of the issues we've been having with rate increases and the utility billing, how do you see the transition happening at our, I'm just worried, you know, for another
change
issue, another mm-hmm. change on top of what we've been seeing.
The reason why the conversion takes so long is that we run this in parallel. So we will do a couple of different billing cycles on our old software and on the new software so that we can work out those glitches ahead of time to see and to get the clerks completely comfortable with how it works. So I have no expectation of, you know, going live with this until I know that we are 100% ready, because I am so I'm reluctant to have it, to address any further issues, that, you know, if it takes us 9 or 12 months before we're 100% confident. We've been very upfront about with the new vendor about all of our concerns and what we've been through, and I'm confident that they're more than willing to work with us and to make sure that we have confidence in their program and the support that we're going to get from them.
In your report, which usually comes at the end of the meeting, I just wanted to ask, because, you know, it sounds like there's continuing to be some difficulties regarding the utility bills, and I just wondered what's happening and, you know, how you guys are resolved, how they're being resolved, how the issues are being resolved.
The only thing I wish I had answers, and that's part of the frustrating part, is that I don't have answers from our current software company. Last month we had 150 bills that we realized did not go out to the customers. It took us several days in order to compare the billing journal to the upload in Smart Bill to figure out who was missing. I reached out to the company to express frustration and try to get an answer as to why that happened, and it was basically blamed on something that we were doing that was impossible for us to have done on our own. And then this month it happened again, which is why customers didn't get their bill until probably the second or the third. They probably didn't get them until Saturday, because again, we noticed that there were like 50 some bills missing, and it happened again. And when we told the software company, they just kind of said, yeah, we've never seen this before. So it validated that it's not something that we're doing. I'm fairly certain that with us making all of these changes, it's causing issues on the back end that aren't apparent, because it's in an area that we weren't even touching, so we wouldn't even know to look for. I mean, it's just doing really strange things, and it's taking us an incredible amount of time to go through everything to make sure that they're right.
But SSI has not been supportive of figuring out where those glitches are.
Not at all. Not at all. I can't get any answers. I can't even get anybody to respond to emails. So it's been very frustrating.
Are you going to need their help to do this conversion?
We need to get our data from them. So.
Wow.
I mean, it's our information. I mean, they know that we're, that our intention is to convert and that we're going to need to get that data. So other people have switched from the company that we're moving from to the company that we're moving to, and it hasn't been a problem. So I'm hoping that it's not a problem for us as well.
Any other comments?
Have citizens been getting bills that they feel are way out of whack with their usage? Is that continuing to happen, or?
I think that people are still expressing frustration with their bills, but as soon as they come in and they talk to us and we're able to, you know, pull their history, recalculate their bill, I mean, there's not an issue with the bills calculating. We're just having strange issues with, like, certain people not getting bills. And I think that a lot of the frustration there for a while was when the rate increase occurred, it was a record-breaking hot month, which really caused a lot of people's bills to be much more than what they'd anticipated. And I mean, people's bills were 50% higher. The village electricity bill that we talked about, I think at the last meeting, was, you know, $100,000 higher than what it normally is. It was almost double for us. So that was the first thing that I was looking at, is how much were people using, and they were using much more. So we haven't found any issues with bills calculating incorrectly. So that's not an issue. It's just all these strange, quirky things that are happening, but it's not the bills calculating, thankfully. Everyone that we've tested and somebody's brought to our attention in order to explain to them has worked out fine. So I am confident.
And some of those unexpected high usage of water, has that been stopped? Is that, you haven't heard from people that, you know?
No, I mean, we have a process that we go through. If somebody has an issue, the first thing we'll do is send out a meter reader. We'll have them reread. If they're not satisfied with that, we can offer to test the meter, and if the meter's fine, then they have to pay for it. And then if they're still not satisfied with that, then they can always come to the Utility Dispute Resolution Board. So we troubleshoot as much as we can down there, and I mean, we haven't had any Utility Dispute Resolution Board meetings, so I think that we're pretty much taking care of any concerns before they're pushed up. So,
and issues with the actual readings, with, I know that there was an issue with a new meter reader maybe not knowing where the meters are located.
Yes.
That's all been taken care of, and everybody's meters are being read?
Yes, everybody's meters are being read. Sometimes the meter reader can't locate them, and if a card is left, I mean, the customer has two choices. They can either, you know, take the card and read the meter on their own and send us in the card, or they can just call us and just politely tell us where the meter is, and we can have the meter reader go back out. So it's just, you know, 2,200 meters, and not all of them are in the exact same spot on each property. Some of them are very difficult to find, so it's a learning curve for the new meter reader. But yeah, he's a very fast learner, so I'm hoping in the next month or two he should have every single meter memorized.
And so, I mean, do you feel like this new billing system is going to provide more information and be easier for our customers to read?
Absolutely.
And understand?
Absolutely. If somebody comes in and they need their current history printed out, I will literally sit down and color code with highlighters what the things are, because it's so hard to read. And even if I highlight, you know, and color code the whole thing, I still have people tell me, you know, they can't understand it. It's just very hard to read currently. And these are actual reports that we will be able to, like, develop and, you know, format on our own to our own liking. And they would even come out on, you know, with Village of Yellow Springs across the top of them, which ours don't. So it's much more official looking, and we can tailor them to meet our needs and to show exactly the information in the way that we would like for it to be presented.
And my recollection was, when with talking about things like net metering, that SSI had issues with net metering. Have these folks are going to be able to deal with net?
Yes, we had, we talked to Johnny, and we had, you know, all of the issues that believe me, they were, when they did their demo, I think that they anticipated for being here for 2 hours. I think we had them here for almost four, because we ended up going through all of the questions of what if, can you do this, can you do that, how about this, what about that? And there wasn't anything that they couldn't do that we need.
I mean, it's a big investment, but if you have the confidence, I mean, I feel like it's something that both for our staff and for citizens that that we need to do. It's an investment we need to make, and I'm glad to hear that you're confident in it. Any other comments or questions? Comments or questions from citizens?
If somebody currently has an
Can you come up, Dale? State your name, please.
Dale Hotaling. If somebody currently has an issue with a bill, they can come in and talk to you to try to resolve it. Are there specific hours for somebody that works to do that? I mean, what are the times they could do that?
The clerks are in the office from 7:30 to 3:30, and the window is open 8 to 3 because it takes them time to get it prepped in the morning and to close it down in the evening. So anybody can call or come in those hours, and, you know, if that's not convenient for somebody, I mean, I can always make an appointment myself and meet with somebody and explain things.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thanks, Dale. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Next is Resolution 2016-48.
Title only.
Let's read it completely.
All right, this is authorizing the village manager to enter into a settlement agreement and release with Naomi Watson. Whereas Naomi Watson, serves as a police sergeant for the village, and whereas a dispute arose regarding the conditions of Watson's employment and an Ohio Civil Rights Commission charge was filed, and whereas the village and Watson have discussed ways to settle the dispute, and whereas the village and Watson have agreed to the terms of a settlement of the dispute, and whereas the village manager recommends village council authorize the village manager to enter into a settlement agreement and release with Watson, now therefore council for the village of Yellow Springs, Ohio hereby resolves that. Section 1, Village Council accepts the recommendation of the village manager and hereby authorizes the village manager to enter into a settlement agreement and release with Watson and to take all actions required thereunder. Section 2, the village manager is hereby authorized to enter into the settlement agreement and release attached hereto as Exhibit A in the same or substantially similar form. Section 3, this resolution shall become effective immediately upon its adoption.
Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Okay. I'd just like to say that how happy I am that this matter has been resolved. It's we've been working on it. A lot of time has gone into it, and it's a good resolution. Sergeant Watson is an important asset, not only to the police department, but to the community as a whole. And this agreement will allow us all to move forward and for Sergeant Watson to perform her duties as she always has.
Chris is going to handle the explanation or answer questions that
okay.
might have.
Any comments or questions?
Maybe.
Council? Citizens?
There's one point I do want to clarify. That is that there is a report that I think has been erroneously circulated that would indicate that the reference to pending discipline was involved the Fannin case. The Fannin case discipline was implemented and accepted and resolved before this matter even came to the point where we were mediating it. So this was a prospective discussion in the context of the resolution that we reached.
Okay. Any questions from council, citizens? Seeing and hearing none, we'll take the vote. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Now is the time in the agenda where we hear from citizens about items that are not on the agenda. We ask that you come up to the microphone, state your name, and you have 3 minutes for your comments.
Good evening, council members and citizens of Yellow Springs. Allow me to introduce myself. My name is Ms. Shia Fields. I live at 503 South High Street. I moved here latter part of May from Beaver Creek. Before then, I lived in Xenia. I have a nonprofit organization called Ms. Shia's Kids Club. I'm a community advocate and activist. Here I have a petition where in regards to needing two stop signs on the corners of South High. Now there presently is two stop signs on West Davis, which does not go all the way through. They speed up and down South High like nobody's business. I live on the corner there, and it's pretty scary. But I'm doing this for the children because school's back in session. They walk up and down the street to school. They skateboard. They bicycle. And I'm just really afraid someone's going to get hurt. And I've taken around a petition. Don't have a lot of signatures. Don't know what to do with it, how to apply it, or how many more signatures I might need.
I don't think you have to worry about a number of signatures at this point.
Any attention that can be brought to this matter would certainly be highly appreciated. And a couple of weeks ago, I was at a function, and there was a piece of paper, a form, that was for people that needed assistance with utilities. If that form still exists, I can get people that need help. I can get those forms filled up for you. I'll sit downtown. There has to be validity to the claim. I won't be asking anybody in $100 sneakers or $60 pair of pants or $40 shirt if they need help, that's for sure. But if there is funding for that, assistance available, I can fill those forms for you. And with those few words, I'd like to yield the floor. Thank you for your time.
Ms. Fields,
would you mind
spelling your first name?
Uh-huh, M-S period C-H-A-Y-A. Like somebody being shy, which I am not, to put an O on the end of it. Fields, F-I-E-L-D-S, and I live at 503 South High. I look forward
Welcome.
To working for you.
Yes.
Any committee, any volunteer work, you need me, I'm there.
That's
we
great.
Always have
Thank
spots
so
on
much.
Our commissions.
Yeah. Yes.
And
okay.
Before you sit down, where are you recommending the stop signs to
On
be?
The two corners of South High. Take them up from West Davis and put them on South High, north and south instead
okay.
of east and west. It's right there. I have two business owners on there. Michael James Hair Salon's on there. Mm-hmm. Ertel Publications is on there. And then Central AME Church is on there, the pastor of Central AME Church. They've signed it as well.
Okay. And so right now,
they just speed up and
no
down
sign,
South High. When
no
they come down South High, there's
South
nothing
High.
Stopping, no yield, no miles per hour sign, nothing.
Yeah, I don't think there's, I think there's at Limestone. Is there even at Limestone?
Yes.
At Limestone.
And then
the rest,
at South College.
Yeah. And then lighting. If you could provide any extra lighting, that would be good too. A lot of the citizens that signed that weren't in agreement with it, but I just know from living there, it's real dark on one side of the street. Very dark.
Could you write your phone number down for
yes,
me,
ma'am.
Please? Just right up here in the corner,
yes, ma'am.
We'll be fine.
So what will we do with?
I think we'll give it to Chief, and they'll do some looking and maybe
if you
some
can't
counts
do anything,
and
maybe have the police sit in the church parking lot and start passing out tickets. The news travels fast. With those few words, I'd like to yield the floor.
Thanks.
I don't want to take up any more of your time. Thank you.
And welcome
Thanks.
To town.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Any other citizens' concerns, Dale?
Still Dale Hoteling. my concern is about the use of land for the CBE on the west end of town. I've lived in town for over 50 years. That I don't think that gives me the right over somebody with less time in town, as we just heard, somebody who's just moved here. But I also feel that we really do need to get the input of the community before making any building on that property. There are 4,000 people in this town, and I feel that this is an important enough decision to bring to a vote before any building goes on. I'd also urge council to look at some other sites, including the old clinic block, which I feel might be a better location for that. You know, my vote will always be to preserve the beautiful land that's the field on the west edge of town. Thank you.
Thanks, Dale.
Thanks.
Anyone else? Okay.
I wanted to Dale had talked to me about the vote about the infrastructure that we had decided to put there from Edom Road out to the road to nowhere, I guess it's, but it's been being dubbed for the time being. That conversation made me think because, and I've had a couple of others with citizens, just how important the trust of citizens of the council, and I think we've had a lot of trust of our citizens, of us as a honest and forthright group who really looks to the interests of the citizens. We try to include the citizens, and I think I would like to see us take a little more care. I think the fact that vote happened so quickly, it made people doubt us and sort of feel you know, it just happened too fast that people didn't get a chance to participate in that discussion. So I just wanted to say to the council that I think, you know, we just need to really protect that trust that the citizens have in us and perhaps take a little more time at certain times to make sure everybody has an opportunity to weigh in.
Thanks, Judith. It is on the agenda. There is a discussion of the CBE on the agenda, so maybe if there's going to be other discussion, we can save it for that.
Okay. Is that the case? I'll get a chance to speak at the end of
when we talk about this, yes.
The extension?
Yes, yes.
Okay.
Any other citizens' concerns that aren't on the agenda? Okay. Next, we have the gentleman from Shook here to talk about the guaranteed maximum price for the water plan. I'm assuming Patty will start the discussion.
I will. We have several representatives from Shook here tonight, and I am going to introduce Joe Mellon and let Joe introduce the rest of the team that he's brought with him tonight so that I don't mess anybody's name up. We've been working with Shook since April something, March. We've had 10 meetings with them to work through the value-added part of the water plant design, along with Gary Williams, who is here from Jones and Henry, who's the primary engineer of record on the project. So I'm going to turn this over to Joe and his team so that they can present the guaranteed maximum price for the water plant.
Yes.
Thank you very much for that introduction. I am Joe Mellon with Shook Construction. Thank you for council and citizens of Village Yellow Springs allowing us to present the GMP or guaranteed maximum price. It was almost 9 months ago to the date that we were in this chambers and you were interviewing design build contractors. And we're thankful that we were selected as that, and we've been working with a great team with the village staff and the criteria engineer with Sam at HNTB. And I'm gonna introduce a few of the folks who are gonna do more talking than I am about the details of our guaranteed maximum price. First is Vince Schwartz, right here. He'll be the project manager, or has been the project manager so far to date, and will be continuing if it's selected. Scott Hutkins would be the superintendent, the guy out in the field building the job. Mm-hmm. Keith Bruner is our director of pre-construction services, and he's been putting together the GMP over the last several months.
Okay. Go ahead.
Gary Williams with Jones and Henry, who is the designer of record. Perrette Wallace will be a project engineer, and taking a top seat up here is Teresa, who's been our modeler and our scheduler. And I'm going to kind of turn it over to Keith Bruner to let him talk to you and walk through the process we've been through so far to date and the GMP.
Again, my name is Keith Burner. I'm Shook Construction. I'm the pre-construction manager on this project. Just wanted to go through real quick the process that we've been through over the last 9 months. I'm going to do it kind of quickly. There's a lot of detail in those books that we gave you earlier that you can look through. I'm not going to run through all those numbers. It'll probably drive you crazy. There's so many of them in there. But if you got any questions, you're more than welcome to ask. I'm just going to do a quick overview on it, talk about the process we've been through so far, and where we're going from here. So first of all is kind of our process that we go through in pre-construction, and it's typically, as you know, we were awarded the project in March of this year. We went through several phases, initially through some schematic and through some, preliminary budgeting. That all happened kind of in that December to March timeframe. In March, we started working on the schematic design, which is just the next step in the drawings. The drawings have been further developed. We've got more details. We understand more about the projects. We worked closely with the village, HNTB, which is the criteria architect, as well as Jones and Henry and ourselves, to start developing and putting all these numbers together. And at first, it's pretty high level. The drawings are very complete. There's 30% drawings, and we look at some schematic stuff. We did that through the April timeframe. The next step leads into the what we call a design development phase of it, which is just another phase of the project, but we're adding more detail to the drawings. We're adding more detail to the specifications. We've got more information to go out to the local subcontractor community to get good feedback and pricing and value engineering ideas, and we just start to develop that more and more. That happened through the June timeframe of this year, until we got to a point we're at now, which is the GMP, the Guaranteed Maximum Price. And that step, I'll talk a little bit more about it, but that was turned into Patty about a week ago or so. We talked about that. And then obviously today's, you know, we're presenting it to the council. A couple of dates that we're looking forward to. One of them is the what we call letter of requirements from the OEPA. We expect that, keeping our fingers crossed, by early next week. We have gotten some initial feedback from the Ohio EPA and have incorporated that information into the GMP, so shouldn't be any surprises there. We hope to get the GMP approval again by the middle of this month, and then the final letter of approval by the end of the month for the GMP. So first of all, we went through the RFP phase, which I talked a little bit about it. And initially with the HNTB design, we budgeted at a really high level of this and looked at this job as about a $10 million job. And obviously we didn't want a $10 million job. So what we did is we spent the next several weeks and months working with HNTB in the village, along with our engineers, Jones and Henry, to come up with value engineering ideas, better ways of doing things, cutting cost. Through that preliminary design, we got that budget down as a total to about $7.4 million. The next step was we worked the schematic design phase, again, developing those drawings more, understanding it more, being able to get the subcontractor, local subcontractor community involved in getting us, you know, some good pricing, some great ideas on how to do things better, more efficient. And we got that budget, again, down a little bit more to $7.2 million as we refined it. And we just keep making those steps. The design development is the same thing. At this point, we can start getting things like the village, we can get the counties, the municipalities, all those, start getting those and put those guys involved in it. Getting our plan approvals, getting information, feedback from them. Again, working with the whole team, we're able to again bring that price down to just a little under $7.1 million. And then in the final, in the GMP, we took this to the market. We took the bid packages out to the local subcontractor communities, put bid packages together, that way you could get competitive market pricing on everything. In doing so, we were able to bring the cost down a little bit. However, we have received some initial Ohio EPA comments on the drawings, which have added a little bit more in. Things like chemical systems and some other items that they've had us put back in, so it's kind of brought that price back just a little bit. But we're still just a little bit over $7.1 million on the GMP. And with that, I think I'm going to turn it over to Teresa. She's got it. And if you guys can see the monitor, she put together the model on this, and I think you'll enjoy a visual look at it.
Thanks, Keith. So some of you might remember when we could just pull this out.
All right. So some of you might remember back in December when we were interviewing for the job, we put together kind of a conceptual look at what the site and the building might look like. But what we've done is as we have gone through and developed the design on the drawings, we've also developed a 3D model to kind of give you guys a really good visual tool to see what the final design looks like kind of in real life.
Oh. Yeah, it's playing on her screen. So.
Oh.
Oops. You're enjoying it.
Yeah. I'm like, there's a bird.
Okay.
Judy, any idea?
I have an idea.
There we go.
I just saw something.
Yeah. There we go.
All right, just let me reset it, and then it will. Okay, there we go.
There's a butterfly.
Oh, there'll be butterflies everywhere, bees and butterflies.
So what's that water there?
Brad, that's you.
Look at Brad.
He's got a new truck.
Yeah, let's hope he got a new truck.
He put it in the budget for next year. So those are the pellet softeners, right?
Correct. Yeah, those two big tanks.
Are the what?
Right there.
The pellet softeners.
Calcium.
Oh, it's not the swimming pool. Okay.
No, it's not a swimming pool.
And then on that back wall is all the admin, laboratory, restroom, electrical room, offices. And with that, Perrette is going to talk about the major construction milestones.
Good evening. Yeah, my name is Perrette Wallace. I'm with DAG Construction, and we are with partnership with Shook, and I know you guys remember me from our first presentation. What I want to talk to you about, what you see up on this screen, is the milestone dates. So pending GMP acceptance on September 19th, our plans are to start construction on September the 20th, which is very soon. The duration for this project from September 20th up until substantial completion would be about a 17-month duration, and that would bring us to mid-December. The time process in between December and, January, the end of January, would bring us to the testing of the facility. And in January, in between January and the beginning of mid of February 2018, the facility would be open or ready for use for the Village of Yellow Springs. So a 17-month process between starting construction and substantial completion, and another 2 months for a final completion and use of the plant for the Yellow Springs Village. So that is the duration. Like I said, all those dates are contingent upon acceptance of that GMP acceptance on September 19th. Me, Ben Swartz is going to come up and tell you about our project team and give you some closing
statements. I have a question.
Sure.
Where is the new plant in relationship to the existing plant?
Down the hill. Yeah, the existing plant sits up on the rise, the little rise, and the new plant will be essentially down the hill in front of
it. So on that schematic.
Yeah, do we have a...
The plant will be right behind.
Like the filter building.
Right there. It's about 15 feet away from
the right. And that the old plant will be in operation during this whole 17-month period.
Yes.
And then what happens to the old plant?
Well, you're going to discuss that here shortly. Because that is the one thing that is not included in the GMP right now is the demolition of the old plant. And that is an alternate that if council chooses to go ahead and do it now, while Shook is mobilized, there's a price in there that we will discuss, and you can add that into the GMP and be done with it. There's also the option of me applying for a brownfield grant to get it cleaned up and using that during that I can apply for that during that time. And if we don't get it, we just pay for it. If we do get it, the grant pays for it or for part of it.
And is decommissioning an option as well?
Not really. Brad, do you want to address that?
Well, our concerns are, we don't really know what's going to happen if we just take it offline in many years. Who knows what it'll be like and how much it might cost, for mold. There could be anything in there years sitting offline and then to demolish it.
It really,
it's never going to be cheaper.
It's never going to be cheaper to demolish it, and it is a, it is going to be a liability for us. We will have to continue to carry insurance on it if it just sits there as opposed to demolishing it. It is the recommendation of staff that we do go ahead and demolish it, so. But we can talk about that after these folks finish.
What if Ms. Horst is going to come up?
Thank you. First of all, I want to thank you for allowing us to present this brief presentation. Also, it's been a pleasure collaborating with Patty, Brad, Johnny with the Village, Sam with HNTB, Gary with Jones and Henry, Perrette with DAG Construction, Chapel Electric, and DJE. Also, we're looking forward to the journey ahead of us in building the new water treatment plant. With that, we'll open it up to questions.
Do you want to talk about the demolition of the old plant now and the additional cost of that?
I mean, there's no way that that building can be used for anything?
Right now, with the shape that that building is in, and we did talk about, can we use it for any kind of storage? Would it be, you know, useful in that way? It's so damp, and essentially, you know, there are certain areas where it's just going to become moldy, and I don't think that there's really any way we can store anything in it.
What about storing the sand that we use?
Well, we're going to store that out at the at the farm, at Sutton Farm, because it will be used on construction projects as backfill. So,
it seems like it would be to me worth not making a decision tonight on that, because we haven't thought about it at all, and we haven't heard from citizens who might have some idea. Maybe there's nothing else to do but demolish it, and if that's, you know, but it seems like it would be worth taking a minute.
Well,
or two.
Think of something great.
And I know the staff's thought about it, and yeah, I don't know. But it's just a thought that we at least let it be out there for a week or two.
Right. I mean, it's going to be the last the last thing. It's going to be not happen until spring probably of 2018. So I would assume that the price, will the price change?
Potentially the price could change.
Yeah,
and it would be a change order on the GMP, which is entirely possible. I mean, there'll be change orders to either add or deduct as the price, you know, if we decide to add something that's not in there, or if we decide to change something and it's a deduct, there's a change order to lower the price.
Wait a minute, but I thought that if we've got the only, isn't this the maximum contract price? Where do we get change orders?
Only if we add something that's not in
here. Okay. I mean, I just want to make that clear.
Yeah, only if we add something that's not listed in here that we decide we want to do additionally.
But it's not listed in there now.
Correct.
Right.
So it's going to be a change order regardless.
It's listed as an alternate.
Right.
There's an executive summary page in there right before all the pricing.
But the main point is that we need to make this decision potentially while Shook is mobilized, right? Because that's how we save costs.
Right. The only thing that you need to remember is that if we don't lock it in with the resolution on the GMP, that it could potentially change from it's $51,393. It could potentially change from that and be slightly more or slightly less.
I think that, you know, something else I would say about it is that given it's already in bad shape, it will require, here we are building this brand new, beautiful building. We'll have, that's going to be not concrete block, it's going to be another material. So we'll have a building of a totally different material to maintain. And it's going to take more money. So where we have an annual maintenance cost for the existing building should be relatively low because it's all new construction. Trying to maintain that existing building is probably going to cost thousands of dollars a year, a few thousand dollars a year, just to maintain that building, and will have paid for the demolition in a few years.
What is the material the new building's constructed of?
Most of it is structural concrete, and then the building itself is a pre-engineered metal building, a galvanized pre-engineered metal building, steel building. But the tanks and the floor and the walls are all cast in place concrete.
And is it insulated?
Yes.
So does it have like 2x4 construction or 2x something within the metal exterior?
It has galvanized purlins, and it has metal wall panels. There are sandwich panels that have an insulation that are on the inside face. If you stood in a doorway, on the outside you'd see metal siding.
Yeah.
And on the inside you'd see a fabricated metal panel that's got an R value to it.
Most of the interior partitions, which are just really the admin and the restrooms, are CMU block walls. And that's to do with long-term, and Gary can probably say better than I can, but long-term care, they last longer. It is a wet environment, it's a humid environment. So you don't want to introduce drywall into those. We chose CMU walls.
What kind of care is needed to maintain the building inside and outside? The metal?
Very minimal. One of the reasons why we chose all the primary and secondary steels hot dip galvanized, which won't require any painting in the future. And with the metal wall panels, the insulation between the exterior and the interior will be protected. The life of the building, Gary's?
A building like that, talking on the order of 30 years before you even think about maybe possibly applying a new coating or something to the exterior.
And yes.
Coating systems are very fine coating systems. The steel building itself, it will easily go 50 years. A lot of it's because it's all galvanized construction. So every piece of steel inside the building will be galvanized. Then, of course, the exterior has got a color coating on top, further protecting it.
The existing, we are repurposing or reusing some of the existing facilities, the clear well, the high service pump room, that was all determined through value engineering. So those facilities, they're getting the high service pump rooms, getting a new roof, new doors, exterior painting to match the coloring scheme of the new building. So there are facilities that are staying, and the structure that we're talking about are the alternate, the demolition is at the actual filter building. And I mean, we could go back and do some further analysis on repurposing that type of building, but I would say you're going to be looking at very similar costs in new roofs, new windows, new doors, painting to try to repurpose that. It's a very, if you've been in it, which some of you sure have, it's a very challenging layout of a floor plan to try to repurpose it. You have clear wells, deep channels, deep pits, and things like that. So it's kind of built for its purpose versus storage or office type, things of that nature.
I think it's likely that demolition makes sense, but I do think that we should give people a little time, because you just don't know what, you know, some citizens might have some ideas. I have no idea, but I just think we should give it a little time. And if we, in a 2 or 3 months, make, you know, nothing's been suggested, then we add it in. So, and how much is it, by the way?
51 and the only thing I'm going to say is that there will be limited access in that area, because, you know, people won't be able to just access the plant. So whatever purpose we, if we choose to reuse it, it will have to be something that, you know, doesn't require the public to be able to get in there.
Well, I agree with Judith, just because making a decision like this, having it just brought to us now. Never thought about it, wasn't discussed at all before. I think we should have some time to think about it.
Well, and go ahead.
No, you go ahead.
In making that decision, you know, it was proposed to us a couple years ago that decommissioning and having a backup was something to consider. So I'd just like to, we don't need to discuss it tonight, but I'd just like that to be clarified why.
We'll have a redundant system, won't we?
We will have, yeah, we'll have a redundant system in the new plant. It will have two redundant 500,000 gallon processes. As far as using this plant to produce water in the future, even in an emergency, I don't know that I think that that's a valid idea, Brad. Yeah, because once we decommission that to get it, you know, cleaned back up and into productive order, I think would be prohibitively expensive. I mean, if we can come up with another purpose for it, you know, that's right. One thing, but I don't think that it's realistic to consider it to be an emergency production facility, especially since we'll have two redundant pathways.
Okay.
And you mentioned legislation, so what's our process with this?
Well, the resolution to approve the GMP and amend the contract with the GMP is scheduled on the next meeting on the 19th is where it is on the agenda. The folks at SHOP would like to have a decision by them because they want to start construction the next day. They were hoping to already be under construction out there.
Okay. Is that, I mean, we'll talk about it. I mean, I would hope that we would maybe be able to make that decision about the demolition. If not, you know, perhaps we could have another couple of meetings to make that decision.
Yeah, I don't think us discussing it gets us anywhere. I just didn't know if there's some citizens out there who have some great idea that we would never think of that would come to us, you know. The likelihood is maybe not that great, but it's just...
Any other comments?
Are we going to discuss the guaranteed maximum price at all now? Or? Well, I mean, I see the agreement, but it seems like it would be good to go over it, if you would.
Just read that.
Well, I'm just looking at the page that says agreement.
The agreement, okay. Just kind of going through, detailing all of the costs.
Okay.
I mean, I don't think you have to read it, but maybe just detail what each of those numbers is for.
So, you want to do
it? Yes.
Yeah, please.
Susan likes it when you speak into the microphone.
Okay. So, this is you're looking at the GMP amendment document? This says agreement. Okay.
No, just the agreement itself. Right?
So right now, just contractually to walk through it, we have a pre-construction services contract for a certain amount to design and come up with a GMP. This is an amendment to that contract. And I'm just going to start off, I'm going to kind of work, I'm going to go to 1.2.1, about halfway down. I'm just going to walk through this. So we have a contract right now with the Village of Yellow Springs for the $600,000 number. Now, what the guaranteed maximum price is 1.2.3, which is that 7,145,215. That's big picture. That's the GMP. If you want to start back up at 1.1, at the top of the page, this is the breakdown on how we get to 7,145. So I'm going to jump right into 1.1.1.1, and that's the cost of the work. That's all the hard costs, the construction costs of this 5.2. That's not engineering, that's not subsurface investigation, that's not contract administration or quality control, or is this the level you want me to go to?
We're spending $7 million, yep. Might as well.
So that's the cost of the work, the nuts and bolts. The next is our personnel cost to manage the job. The next 1.1.1.2 through 1.1.1.6 are what we call the soft costs. And that's So I'll start off with 1.1.1.2. That's our construction personnel. That's guys like these two out here on the job site managing the construction project, and others, Teresa and Perrette, managing the process. And there's an exhibit in here that outlines that cost breakdown. It's a not to exceed number. It's an hourly rate. And it's the same number that we presented back in December. So 1.1.1.3 is the general conditions cost. Those are things like the construction trailers and power and utility and bonds and insurances to protect during the construction cost. And that's an exhibit in here also, and there's a breakdown, and that's a not to exceed cost also. And that was the same document that was submitted back in December. So then there's a contingency. So there's a 5% contingency on the job. That's for things that were unexpected, unavoidable. There is a shared savings clause on that contingency, where if we don't spend any of that money, the Village of Yellow Springs is the recipient of 60% of it, and the design builders the recipient of 40% of it. So there could be potential a reduction in cost from your standpoint of the overall GMP, and that would be handled by a change order. But it's a contingency to protect the what ifs that come up, and we hope they're not. We trust that Gary is provided.
Probably will be.
but there always is, so it's smart to have it. The next 1.1.5 is the construction design services fee. That's Jones and Henry continuing to work through the shop drawings. There'll be a lot of shop drawings from equipment vendors on the job, and he'll be receiving those and reviewing and making sure that our subcontractors and our suppliers, I apologize, my back's to you, subcontractors and suppliers are incorporating the materials that are specified, and there's fees, there's time and hourly rates associated with that. And then there's our fee, which is profit in essence, and 1.1.6, and that's 2.75%, and that's the same fee that was provided back in December. So when you add the pre-construction services contract of the $600,000 there in 1.2.1, plus the construction services, which is to actually build the job now that it's been designed, we will get to a total amount of 7.145215. And I guess I'll just say that you've already spent the 617 to get to here, or tomorrow, but to get to this point. The next article is our contract times, and Perrette went through that. That's with an anticipation of September 20th starting and final completion by 2018 and February of 2018. And the village citizens would see water being sent out to distribution in first part of February. I think it was February 1st or January 31st of 2018. So then the next page is Article 3, and that's a list of exhibits that all make up this amendment. I can go into those, but I'll start first by just summarizing. The basis documents, Exhibit A, that's the drawings that Jones and Henry has prepared. That's the specifications. It's the soil borings. It's the basis of design. It's the what you see up in that modeling, clearly defined in a certain amount of pages, and specifications that are called out for. So you have to tie the project to something of in black and white, right? So that's it. That's the drawings and specifications. That's what you're buying as an owner. And then if there are any changes that were brought up earlier, those would be handled. Not that's not in those design documents. I don't know what a good example is. You need a lawnmower because you're mowing 3 more acres of grass. That's not in the, there's no mower in our design documents, so you'd have to go out and buy a lawnmower. You could have us do it if you wanted to, but that would be a change order. But for on that same type of example, there is a forklift in the specifications so that they can raise and lower the sand that goes into the pellet softening system. So whatever's shown on those drawings and those specifications is the basis of design documents. So then there's an exhibit B, and that's an exhibit of our assumptions that we've made and clarifications through this process as a team. And we've shared those assumptions with Patty and Brad and Johnny and Sam throughout the process that we've gone through. So we've identified all those in exhibit B, what those assumptions and clarifications and exceptions are. And there are some there are more clarification on how we handle the construction process, and there are some things in here, for example, that aren't included. And I'll give it, one of the examples is, let's say there's an existing generator in one of the rooms, in the electrical room. Based on discussions, we've left that generator stay in that room. We haven't removed it, we haven't done anything with it, and it's just, that's a clarification that at the end of the day when we leave, the generator will be still in that, the existing generator will still be in that room. There are exceptions. Another example is there was some low communication lines from the existing plant out to the well field that were low, like 10, 15 feet off the ground, that would require them to be raised or relocated so we could actually come in and construct the lagoons and the water plant. We could do that for a price, or Johnny said he could do it for himself internally to save on costs. So that's one of the exceptions, that we're not doing it, you are doing it. So that's kind of what Exhibit B is about. It's an important document. All the exhibits are important. Exhibit C is the cost of the work, and that's basically that $5.2 million number. There's every breakdown of every cost is in that exhibit, from concrete per cubic yard to moving dirt to laying pipe to putting in the process of the softeners and the filters and starting it up. Everything that is an open book accounting that you can look at the cost and see where we developed our number from. There's also in there, as Keith mentioned, we took it to Marketplace on August 15th. Is that right? 12th? I think it was August 15th. We had bid date. We had bid packages where we solicited pricing from subcontractors and suppliers, and we got that pricing in. All that pricing is in this Exhibit C, as well as, that's not here in front of you, but Patty has, and Sam, and I'm not sure if you guys have, but there's a book on every bid package that we received, and every price, a bid package from a subcontractor, and every vendor's price that we solicited from, and it breaks down and analyzes who the best value subcontractor was or who the best value vendor was. And those prices are incorporated into this Exhibit C. Exhibit D is pretty self-explanatory. It's project scheduled. It's in here. And Exhibit E is the alternate, which the only alternate on the job right now we've briefly discussed is the demolition of the existing filter building. So this document is what makes up the GMP, and then, or this agreement is the GMP, and then behind it is all the supporting documentation, all the exhibits. And I can go into
detail.
I think that's enough.
Raise your hand, tell me to stop talking. I can talk to you all night about this.
So do we have more opportunity besides just that contingency? Do we have more opportunity to take the price down if there happen to be change order reductions?
Well, there's two other areas. The design builder's construction stage personnel cost is a not to exceed number, and we may not get to that 449,900. More likely we will. That's a hard one because it's a fixed duration. The only way not to get to that is if usually you have to spend money to accelerate the schedule because it's all based on a duration, and more than likely that'll be there. The contingency is the area, and then the general conditions, and that's pretty fixed unless the things that reduce there is if the overall, let's just say there's deduct change orders, then you get credit back or reduction on bond costs and insurance costs, and as you reduce the scope of the contract overall, it's just a rotating, or it's a circulating formula that the fees drop because they're all percentage based. There is also the design fee that we've talked with Patty about that's in this. Okay, so if you go to 1.2.1 under right under pre-construction services, it says pre-con design service fee not to exceed, and that's $500,000. That's going to come in, Gary, roughly.
It'll be under $400,000.
So there will be a savings right there, and that would be adjusted probably around the October time frame. So there is a significant savings also.
I just like our staff, Brad, everybody to know, I mean, anything that can be done, anything more that our staff can do, anything that Johnny can do from an electrical standpoint, you know, just this is, you know, we're excited about this. I think it's important, it's necessary, but, you know, anything we can do to keep this cost down and to value engineer, which is really one of the reasons that we were looking at design build. So,
well,
you know, we really appreciate
this. And we've talked about a lot of those things. I mean, you know, Johnny's moved the lines. Brad has, you know, done some things that, you know, we decided that, for instance, and you guys know this is my thing, is the soffits on the building. It costs $17,000 to add soffits to that building. And does it make it look nicer? Yeah, but it's $17,000. So we took them off, and the gutters look perfectly nice along the top, and you know, Brad's working to kind of streamline things on his end, and so we are looking to that, and Shook has worked with us. Like I said, we've had ten meetings, right, Vince?
Yes.
And so we've worked through. I think we probably picked them. Sometimes I kind of felt like Shook was like, man, these people don't want to spend money, but. But, you know, that was what we were there to do, and so.
Okay, great.
I was going to say I have a lot of confidence in what the staff and Karen and Jerry, you know, from Yellow Springs side, and what you presented. I mean, I don't know much about these things, so I'm not going to be able to. I have to trust, and I do trust, that this has been a good process, the product will be good, and I think that's about as much as we can really figure out tonight. So,
okay.
And the price sounds like it's come down substantially, which I'm pleased to see. It's still high, and it's a lot for a small community, but that's nobody's fault here. That's just the fact. So I personally would like to kind of try to move forward on the agenda.
But yeah, I have another question.
Sure.
On Exhibit E, the allowance for removal of the old building. So it indicates that it would include an assessment of whether there's hazardous material.
Correct.
But if there is hazardous material, the removal of that would cost more. So I guess my questions are both to you and maybe to Brad. Do we think that there is asbestos? I guess would probably be the. Do we think there are asbestos and lead materials in the building? And then if so, can anyone say approximately how much more that will cost to remove those?
The assessment itself should be less than this allowance that's within the alternate. Unless, you know, there's something really out of whack with the entire roof or Usually what you're concerned with is lead paint. We can handle lead paint internally ourselves with certain practices and protocols that go in place, and it's not a very big deal. Things that are a big deal are asbestos, caulking around windows, roof systems that have asbestos into it, and that's probably the biggest area in this certain circumstance is the roof of the building, because there's not many windows, and you can, as long as you maintain the integrity of the removal on like windows and caulking, then it's not, again, there's a disposal fee, but there's not a lot of extensive labor fee. The roof could probably be the biggest exposure, but I still think even with this allowance, we should be covered with the assessment and the removal.
And I will tell you, Mary Ann, that we actually, you know, we've talked several times about the building at Sutton Farm, the house out at Sutton Farm, and how we'd like to perhaps see something done with it, but we were concerned that it had asbestos in it, so we actually had it tested. And there's very little asbestos in there, just in some of the drywall tape. And so even the roof on that building out at Sutton Farm does not contain asbestos.
But so, at any rate, what I think I hear you saying is your sense is that this 51,000 plus would probably cover hazardous material removal.
Unless way outside the scope of what would normally be expected to be there.
Okay,
case. I don't even want to know about it. Having that hazardous materials around, hopefully it's not too much. Okay, so we will move on. Thank you so much to all of you. Thanks for all coming.
Thank you.
We look forward to September 20th. Patty, we're okay with Patty bringing the resolution to the next meeting for construction, amending the contract with Shook Construction for the design-build water plant to reflect the guaranteed maximum price.
Right. Yes.
Okay, thank you all.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Moving on to old business, we'll start with the climate action report. Mary Ann, do you want to start that, or are we just going to go straight to Dorn?
Well, Deward Headley is on our Environmental Commission, and he's taking leadership on the Climate Action Plan and has come to council two times before with updates, and this time he's coming to council for council, I think, to make a decision about how where we want to start in this deal. So
first of all, I'd like to thank the council and staff for this opportunity to talk with you and the community about this important topic. Also like to apologize for the materials being later than expected. I had my dates wrong. I'm going to talk today. First, I'm going to provide an update on our climate action planning process, what we've accomplished. The key issue was we run into a challenge, so I'm going to talk about that challenge and then some options we have for moving ahead. Any questions before I get started?
No.
Jump into it? All right. So it's always good to start off with some notable recent climate change events. May 2016 was the 13th consecutive warmest month on record, so for over a year we continued to set world records for the warmest month. July was the warmest month on record ever, which meant June wasn't, if you can figure that out. But anyhow, that was also, I think, the month that you were speaking about earlier when our utility rates changed. So I think that's a really good example of how climate change has real impacts on our community, and unfortunately it impacts the people who have the biggest challenge paying and often live in houses that aren't as new and as well insulated. So I think that's a great example of why this is relevant. I'm not going to go through all the other things. There was 6 months of events that the Yellow Springs Community Foundation funded and the Community Solutions and the Resilience Network put on, covering a wide topic of issues related to climate change. So there's a lot of other things that are going on, but you live here, you probably know a lot of that. So we could go on to the Let's go back one. Where are we at? This is not the same presentation. No, this is a different. This is a different.
This is what I have from you.
I must have sent you the wrong thing. Do you guys have? Does the council? They don't.
We don't. No. But yeah, sorry.
How about if I get put it on?
Yeah.
Do we want to? Do you need? Do you guys need some time?
Yeah,
maybe we can move ahead to something, to another discussion. Or is this going to take a while?
No,
or?
It's going to take about 3 seconds.
Oh, okay. Mm-hmm. Sorry. Okay.
Is that something you can make copies of real quick? It's printed out. Well, he had something printed out.
Dor, do you have a hard copy?
I only have a hard copy of my notes.
Oh, okay.
We'll provide one afterwards. So I was talking about local and national events, global events. What I'd like to go into is what we've accomplished, actually what a climate action plan is. It's been a while since we've talked. So this is just to recap the climate action planning process. Climate action plan ultimately is a plan where you define a course of action to reduce your greenhouse gas emissions to specific target levels. Specifically, the process, the things that we have done so far, we've committed to taking action. We've joined ICLEI, which is the organization that provides software and resources for developing your plan. We've established what the scope of our climate action plan will be, and specifically, that's what sources we want to include within that plan. And we've completed a kickoff to where we introduced the process to the community and received input from the community. And then last November, we began the actual process of collecting our greenhouse gas inventory, which is a very technical process to where you collect data relative to things like your electricity usage, your transportation, how much waste you generate, how much gas for home heating fuel and things like that are used. And that's effectively what we've accomplished so far. And unfortunately, during that greenhouse gas inventory process, we ran into a challenge. I want to go ahead and go on to the next slide. So the real challenge we ran into is data availability, right? The key things, the key data that we need spans, as I said, everything from electricity to transportation information to what kind of fuel people use in their homes. And unfortunately, for our area, a lot of that data is not readily available. Our assumption was that we were, you know, based upon the initial conversations we had, was that we were going to be able to get access to the primary data, and that that was going to make the greenhouse gas inventory something that was feasible using the resources of the Energy Board, the Environmental Commission, and village staff. So unfortunately, that's not true. We have the basic data we have is we have good electricity data, and we have decent data from a waste perspective, but then all of the other dimensions that we need data on, that primary data just doesn't exist. It's not something that we collect as a village, and not something that we certainly store historically. So that's the challenge that we've run into. Using the resources that we have available, we're just not able to establish what our actual annual greenhouse gas emissions are, or we're not able to establish our baseline. So that's a challenge that we run into. In a normal climate action planning process, this is a critical step, right? You need a baseline in order to define how much you want to improve from that baseline, and then to be able to measure your progress back to that baseline. So we're essentially at a point to where we can't move forward on the path that we're on today.
So what do you suggest, Stuart? Because you must have some suggestions.
So I have some great suggestions.
Yeah.
There's really three options if you want to go ahead and go to the next slide. The three options, the first one is continue doing what we're doing, which is making decisions to making decisions as a village and a village council, giving priority to lowering, doing things we know are lowers our greenhouse gas emissions. What we've done with our village power, that's a huge commitment. The solar array that we're working on is another thing that we'll continue to do that. So we can continue to make those decisions and do things that are obvious. That will have an impact. The challenge, the good things is it's the lowest cost and it's the easiest things to do, but the challenge is that there's really no formal plan. So, you know, that we don't have targets that we've established. We won't be able to compare ourselves to what other communities are being done, and we really won't be able to be recognized externally if we follow that course of action. Not that we shouldn't continue to do that. The kind of a mid-level step is to move forward and create our climate action plan without the greenhouse gas inventory. And there what we would do is we would, in general, there are major areas that cause greenhouse gas emissions. I listed some earlier. We would effectively develop a plan that says we're going to do some specific things across all of these areas that would result in a positive directional impact upon our greenhouse gas emissions. Again, there would be no formal measurement. We'd be able to estimate the impact, and again, it would not be something that would be recognized formally by external entities.
Stuart, can you explain what you're not able to gather?
Sure.
What are you missing?
Sure. So if you look at the dimensions, I mentioned electricity. Solid waste is another one. Those are the two areas that we can really get after. Getting at specifics, one of the big challenges has been around transportation. The transportation data, typically in cities you have transportation data from various meters and things like that. Yellow Springs just doesn't have ongoing transportation data that is relevant. There's a couple of meters on 68, but we really don't have that information in terms of how many vehicle miles are traveled on which kinds of roads. And another challenge that's specific to Yellow Springs, we have a pretty unique fleet as a village. You look around and know, the ratio of Priuses to SUVs is pretty lopsided compared to a lot of places. And so getting the specifics in terms of where we're at from a transportation perspective, that data just isn't available. So what you can do is you can use state or regional level data and a series of calculations and extrapolate that down to our level and come up with an approximation. But to do that, you know, there's a lot of work, and like I said, it's really beyond the I don't want to say the skills, but the level of commitment and the resources that we have available across the Energy Board, some of the time that we have from the village staff and the environmental commissions. That's just one example. Across all the other dimensions like housing, there's data for that you need in terms of what kind of heating fuels are used within your community. So there's a lot of natural gas that's used, and that data has not historically been available. We can capture it going forward, but it's not historically been available, so we haven't been able to capture our baseline. Things like home heating fuels, that's another example of some of the data that's needed. Data on your industry and in terms of their energy use and their fugitive emissions. I know we don't have a lot, but we're also a very small community, so just a little bit of fugitive emissions from, say, a brewery can be relevant to your greenhouse gas emissions.
What is fugitive emissions?
Fugitive emissions are, so you have a process, and I don't want to pick on the brewery, but say you're fermenting something, and that fermentation results in creation of carbon dioxide. And I love the brewery, by the way, especially the lager, Pilsner lager. Anyhow, so you have processes, industrial processes, that just because of the nature of the process cause emissions, right? So you're not burning a fuel or something like that, but the nature of the process actually causes greenhouse gas emissions. Dry cleaning is a big one. We no longer have a dry cleaner, but that's historically been a big source of greenhouse gas emissions. So since we don't have historic data, we could potentially collect it going forward, but just that data collection process is a pretty significant challenge to creating that greenhouse gas emissions baseline.
Did you have three?
So the second one is to effectively move forward with a plan that would collect community input and also get your input, and I could go through the detailed process, but I won't, to where we could create, I would call it an initial or a directional climate action plan, right? So instead of just saying these are some things we want to do intuitively, this would be a little more specific and based upon general scientific information as well as community input. The final option is to pursue a formal climate action plan, do what other communities like Oberlin have done, and actually seek external consultation, external consulting firm, and effectively pay somebody to facilitate that process, to do all of those hard calculations. And that would ultimately, you know, that is the most guaranteed road forward. We're going to definitely have a plan. It's certainly the most expensive, definitely tens of thousands of dollars. I'm not in the business, so I wouldn't want to come up with a firm fixed price on that. But it's definitely the most expensive. But that is the only road to getting to, that I see at this point, to getting to a plan that would be recognized by external entities and would have a formal baseline and formal measurement of our progress.
And are you aware of any funding for the third option, grant funding or?
Yeah, I think the challenge is, unlike most things, we're pretty late in the game on this. So, you know, those funding sources generally, and also the state that we live in, is not the most proactive in that area. So generally those sources have gone to, you know, in the past, and I'm not aware of any of that.
So, Duard, related to the first two options, it sounds like no matter what, we'd have difficulty measuring the impact.
I think if you establish a formal baseline, the challenge is that then when you go to measure the impact, you've got to go through that same process. So that would be a consideration and would be a continued cost as well.
Right.
I'm wondering whether council would want to task the Environmental Commission to further develop the pros and cons, I guess, of these three options and maybe even make a suggestion.
I guess I'd like money and time and energy to be spent on actually doing something instead of making up this, instead of coming up with a climate action plan. I mean, it sounds like we're going to spend tens of thousands of dollars and countless staff and volunteer hours doing something that is basically just coming up with a number instead of actually doing something that's solving
that
a problem.
Would be number three, the third option is what you're hoping.
I am not, the actual climate action plan was never that important to me. I mean, it's actually getting to some solutions and to getting to some programs that the community could potentially take advantage of to help them reduce their carbon footprint, reduce their energy bills, whatever. That's what's more important to me.
I think that is the key question, right? What does the Village Council and the Village want from a climate action plan? Do we want to be externally recognized and to be able to be highly quantitative about our progress?
No. I mean, I thought that's what ICLEI was, you know. I mean, this whole thing about joining ICLEI, I thought that they were going to provide tools that were going to get us to this. Apparently, they aren't.
They have the tools, we just don't have the inputs.
Yeah.
And we probably should have known that.
I don't know. Maybe there is something more that we get from having a plan that's quantitative, but I don't understand exactly what it is. Well, we know if we're moving in the right direction, maybe. but I know at the next Energy Board meeting, one of the things we're going to talk about, because of the high utility bills people are struggling with, you know, looking at water use and energy use, you know, especially in times of high heat, and then trying to maybe find some funding for those who really don't have the resources to help them to reduce their usage. In terms of transportation, yeah, I mean, I don't know if there's something that we learn if we had proper data that actually can lead to more services that could reduce, you know, people's transport use of individual cars or whatever, you know, if there's some kind of plan can come out of that. You know, I know Green Cats, you know, is a little public transportation system, but it's very tiny. So I don't know.
So I think the only value of quantification is those things that you listed there where intuitively you say, that could be interesting. You know, then you can actually calculate the impact of those decisions, right? That, and I'm not trying to sell that option, I'm just saying that the quantification does provide a measure for the debate of which thing should we do. That's the only value there that I see.
I mean, I think a community like ours can, if we just put our minds onto some programs and some ideas that will help reduce. I think I'm most concerned right now about utilities and energy use right now. I think the transportation, I think we're already way ahead of the curve on transportation given how many people walk and ride bikes, you know, and I think that, you know, maybe we could do more to promote ride sharing and things, but if you read Facebook, people are ride sharing all the time. So, I mean, I think this community does a pretty good job. So I would rather our energy, our time, our resources be going into actual programs. And I think that are going to give results to our citizens, financial results to our citizens. And I think we'll know intuitively that if somebody's got a better insulated house or they're using less resources, we're reducing our carbon footprint. I don't think having this number at the end of it to compare ourselves to other communities is a, I mean, that's not important to me. It's, you know, it's nice, but not if it's going to take a lot of resources.
So I very much agree with taking action and helping people and equitable solutions, but it's kind of counterintuitive since we've largely solved the problem of greenhouse gas emissions from electricity in Yellow Springs. Transportation actually then does become like the next big target on the list.
Except this village council has, other than bikeways, we can only do with transportation what our infrastructure is about. You know, I would say that somebody else would have to bring that to us. I don't know that we have the resources to develop a transportation plan. I don't know if that's where we want to go, or some way to a ride sharing. I just don't see that as something that I feel like council should be prioritizing right now. I think it's something we can support, but potentially.
I guess I'm thinking, if transportation is the next thing, I mean, what if other people who have gotten the monies and they got the data and all that, where did the data lead them? Maybe we can learn where the data leads you without knowing what our data exactly is. So
I think that's what I was saying about the middle option. I don't know that we necessarily need the data.
Uh-huh.
I think we have to be smart about understanding our current situation and establishing what our priorities are when we develop our plan. And that's why climate action planning has always been local. We're a unique community, so I think, you know, that's one of the important things, is to establish the overall plan was to establish our baseline and our target reduction targets, and then our plan on how to get there. So I think what we're talking about here is the kind of things we'd like to see in our plan outside of those specific targets.
Brian, do you
have
input into this?
Yeah, I mean, I think that, you know, what we're talking about is we don't really have the resources that we need and the ongoing expense. I mean, I think measurement and planning is hugely important, but at the end of the day, it's about borrowing those best practices and figuring out how they apply to Yellow Springs. So if we can do something like option two, I think that's great. If there's capacity between EC and EB to do that, Energy Board, Environmental Council, Commission.
Okay. Well, I mean, my sense is that we can take this back to the Environmental Commission and work with the Energy Board, Community Solutions, the Yellow Springs Resilience Network to come up with some action steps, mm-hmm. proposed action steps.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
And then I just emphasizing the one thing that we talked about repeatedly is the utility piece, and I think that's our priority.
Okay, moving on.
I just wanted to thank you for the work that you're doing. And, you know, we may not know exactly how to respond, you know, to it, but anyway, I appreciate it.
Next item on the agenda is the draft RFP for the Dayton Yellow Springs Road Utility Extension. I will turn this over to either Patty or Melissa. It will be turned over to staff for comment.
This is the project that that council asked me to bring the draft RFP for, that will extend the infrastructure from East Enon Road down to the turn lane entrance to the CBE property. This is the draft version of that the council asked me to bring to this meeting.
And other than the fact that it won't say draft, will there be any difference?
Nope, that would be it.
Okay. And are you
the dates.
Pre-bid conference, are the dates, or if we move forward as you would, as potential, I mean, if we look at it now, make comments, if you decide to move forward at the next meeting?
If you pass the resolution at the next meeting, the dates that are in there are the dates that that would be required, yes.
Can you just say what they are?
My copy of this is really messed up on my computer, it did not copy properly. The pre-bid meeting would be Friday, September 30th at 9 a.m. The bids would be due it's probably easier
October
to find it.
October 11th, I think.
That is probably correct. Let me look at my calendar.
Yeah, it says open the bids October 11th.
Yes, October 11th, and then we would let the contract at the next meeting after that, which would be the 11th, 17th, and I would assume that they would begin work pretty quickly to try to get it done by the end of the year.
Any comments, questions?
I don't have any questions or really about the bid or the RFP bid package, but I assume that there are people here in the audience.
Well, I just, any, right, but I just wanted to start here, so.
No, I don't have any.
Okay. Comments or questions from citizens? Dawn, come on up.
Committee has been formed.
Can you state your name, please?
Dawn Johnson, 234 North High Street. A citizen committee has been formed to bring forth a citizen initiative resolution. An initiative resolution by the electorate of the Village of Yellow Springs imposing a temporary development moratorium upon and for the lands formerly known as the Center for Business and Education, the CBE, and specifically parcel numbers F16-0000-01000-600-02500, F19-0000-10002-000-300, F19-0000-10002-000-060, F19-0000-10002-000-700, pending a formal visioning and planning effort for that property that involves and accepts input by the village residents upon and according to the results of those efforts and only by those efforts affirmed by a majority vote at a regularly scheduled election subsequent to the planning effort, the temporary development moratorium may be lifted. This initiative resolution is determined to announce and affirm the voice of the voters of Yellow Springs. This will be delivered to the clerk tomorrow morning, and we will commence signature gathering at that point.
Thank you.
Can I ask, wait, I have a question.
What that's about?
Wait, can I ask you? I have a question.
Yes.
Should she stay there?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, okay. So is this about, does this have anything to do with the infrastructure, or does it have to do with?
Absolutely. Yes, it's a moratorium on development until the village does planning, and I'll go through the whereases if you'd like.
No, that's fine.
I just, it's in the right of way, so that's why
right,
I'm
so we're not developing that property.
No, but it's for that property and why you're doing that.
Yeah. Could we have copies? Because
it's not official until they get signatures. Yeah. I mean,
okay.
Is this something that has to go through the Board of Elections?
It will indeed, yes. We will deliver our copy to the clerk tomorrow, and once we do that, we'll begin our signature gathering.
Okay, thank you.
I'm making you aware of that now.
That's fine,
yeah,
okay.
Thanks.
I don't think that needs to affect our, it just as happened before, we made a decision to move forward, and because of citizen action, the action was stopped. And I see that the same thing could happen if council agrees. I mean, we still have to, the last meeting we made the decision that we would
the majority decision that we would support extending the utilities to the turn lane, and the schedule is that we will have legislation to put the RFP out, to put the project out for bid at the next meeting. And if council sees fit, there's no reason not to move forward with that. And then the citizen action will
if we let an RFP, if the village lets an RFP, and then legally we're stopped, what does that mean? I'm just curious.
Well, I mean, if this
I mean, if so, you know, if we
if this the, is going to go to a vote of the general electorate, there's no way it can get on the November ballot. So if it's going to go in a general election, it's going to be in 2017.
You know, I mean, this is action that we are totally unfamiliar with. There is really nothing that we can do about it. It's up to whether this is it's properly filed and it's a proper action, and it's up to hearing from our solicitor as to what action. You know, we don't have any action to take tonight, really. I mean, at this point, I feel like we could just we could keep it on the agenda. We could either take it off or we could vote it down. We could do
Well, I guess I'm confused
choose.
Because there's the CBE land, or the I think it would be good to take that name away.
I agree.
But anyway, and I don't, please do not go over the property numbers again. Yes. But we know the land that we're talking about. There's that property that's going to be owned by the village. That's one thing.
Potentially.
Well, okay, I'm not going to go there right now.
No comments from citizens on. No comments from citizens, please.
So there is the land that is north of Dayton Street and west of Antioch Midwest. There's that land. We know what that land is. And then there is what we're talking about
is
tonight.
The right
of way. What this is about taking the infrastructure up Dayton Street.
Right.
Two separate things. Now, the one thing I'm not clear about is, and I totally support the community being behind whatever happens there. That's what I want. But is this, I'm not clear whether this document that Don is.
It most certainly does cover this.
Covers the extension
yes.
of the utilities on Dayton Street?
On the incorporated land west of East Bank Road and north of Dayton Street, and currently unserved by village utilities. Said temporary moratorium is to extend to the provision of and for utilities to that location and to extend to all applications for any type of development.
We have no idea if this is legally allowed. We have not heard from our solicitor. What I would say is that we shouldn't talk about what they're proposing and what this petition is. We need to wait till the next meeting. Unless a majority of us want to take it off of the agenda completely, I don't see. We're not going to be able to figure this out as
yeah.
it is. It's a total.
Well, since the citizens group is doing
right.
this, I'm glad that it was brought to our attention.
Right.
So thank you for that.
And you said that's going to go to Judy tomorrow?
Yes.
Okay. Dean, I saw your hand up. Okay. So any other comments or questions? Oh, go ahead.
Katie Anderson. This is a response to the last council meeting discussion where I quote, this is a quote from Brian, there is no hidden plot. I want to put the context of what I'm going to read to you in a thread of emails concerning this document. It's the synopsis of significant events for the Center for Business and Education. I always want to say CBE. All right. So from Patty Bates to Judy Kintner, Melissa Van Zandt, Denise Swinger, copy Karen Wintrow, date Thursday, 14 July. Chris wasn't sure on resolution or ordinance, so I took the precaution of making the lengthiest on the question of order. One of the things brought up last night was that CR wanted to assure that we would move forward with the infrastructure. So the resolution for the grant needs to come first. Timeline was Karen and Brian indicated they wanted last night. As far as length of time working on it, not a bad idea, but my concern is that some would see it as us having started immediately after the referendum as a way to circumvent it. Thoughts? Email from Brian Hausch to Patty Bates, Judy Kintner, Melissa Van Zant, Christopher Connard, and Karen Winchow, Denise Swinger. Recap of timeline. Good morning, Patty. This document looks good to me and appears to reflect what we concluded at Wednesday's meeting. I do not think that the bold parts need to be included, and I would also recommend making it clear that the Army Corps of Engineers grant should, will, question mark, cover all costs for extending the utility infrastructure to the turn lane, highlighting our intent not to spend taxpayer dollars on this project and shutting down referendum references. Thanks, Brian. From Karen Winchow to Patty Bates. I hope you can figure this out. I would like to do a celebratory groundbreaking, but we don't need to include that. We also need to decide what to do, when to do the CR recognition, and exactly what that is, probably September 6th. The original Army Corps of Engineers grant was to install water, sewer, and stormwater infrastructure inside the CBE property, but we all know that project didn't go forward. In an effort to retain the grant, staff began working with ACE to reduce the project scope to simply take the water, sewer, stormwater infrastructure along the right-of-way from Enon, East Enon Road to the existing turn lane entrance on the property to Dayton Yellow Springs Road, but not inside the property. This changed the scope and enhances the value and the use of the property without additional village investment. I'm asking you to table the amendment for more public input.
Thank you. Any other comments?
I think the main thing is that we...
Name.
Chrissy Cruz. There were already questions about what was going on with this property and this transaction, and I think the main issue is that the moratorium to stop work on it is necessary because people aren't feeling that we're really being included. We've lost a lot of faith that, you know, we had this referendum, if the community voted, and it seems like people went right on, like, figuring out how to get around the referendum. And so I don't feel confident that the village is gonna be included. I don't feel like the old plans for this property are in any way acceptable, that we need to look at it in a whole new way. And I don't really feel very confident that we'll be included. This whole thing was rushed through. Anybody that would say that Chrissy Cruz is not paying attention to CBE events and concerns is wrong, because that's one of my main things. So it was rushed through. There wasn't a lot of discussion. And now we find out there was a lot of stuff back and forth going on behind the scenes, contrary to what you said, that there wasn't, and there was. And so the moratorium is because we've lost faith that this council is going to do the right thing with this property.
Well, I guess I would like to say something. My understanding of the vote, the referendum, was about whether the village government was going to take out a loan of, I think, $1.3 million to fund the infrastructure on the CBE. That's my understanding of what the vote was about, and we all know that the citizens voted against that. I did not understand that vote was against anything happening on that property. In fact, of course, it was not. Now, clearly, there are people who want corn to be on that property. I get that. And there are people that probably want a whole bunch of other things. I mean, clearly, to me, the community is very divided about what they want to have happen on the property. So that's why I think it's very important that we figure out a way to have conversations about this where we actually can talk to each other, because we are not talking to each other right now. We are in this place of not trusting. And I guess I didn't see anything in the emails that Kate read, that I, to me, were behind the scene. I mean, we have to do work. Not everything happens in the public eye. And frankly, I'll tell you, sometimes it's better that it doesn't. Because probably any one of you know that sometimes it's very hard to have some difficult conversations in the public eye. And that doesn't mean that you, that automatically people are trying to hide something. But we have to get past this place. Because if we can't get past the place of this lack of assumption of lack of trust, assumption that we can't trust each other, we're not going to be able to talk about this. And that's why I will do everything I can do to make sure that
Dale, you need
nothing
to be recognized.
Happens on that property until there's a sense of significant community buy-in. And I mean, I think whether it's community forums, whether it's having different kinds of discussions in different groups that people are in, whether it's the Economic Sustainability Committee looking at it, whether it's we say we step back and we're not going to do anything, we're just going to talk about it for a year. I don't know, but this whole thing about that property and economic development as a whole has got this community like in a stalemate, and at the same time we have people who are hurting because of the utility rate increase. So something's got to give.
And just to be clear, the language of the referendum was determining to proceed with the Center for Business and Education Public Improvement Project and authorizing the village manager to retain bond counsel and solicit bids from contractors. It was for the project to develop the interior of the property, it wasn't to say that that property was not going to be developed at all. And in much discussion from John Eastman, who was a member of Community Resources at the time, he brought to council the idea of simply taking that Corps of Engineers money and taking it, using it to take the utilities to the entrance to the development. So this isn't something that just came out of nowhere. And I did not hear, and again, there is a need for this property. There is a need for, there are businesses, I've talked to a business that is hoping in the next couple of years, they're looking for a place. They're hoping that there will be a place for them to move. I mean, we are talking about businesses leaving this community. It's happened in the past, and we're back to that place again where there is no place for a business to move in Yellow Springs. And it's not an industrial plant or whatever it might be. There's zoning that controls where it can go. It can't go. Every parcel isn't suitable for all of the options and all of the opportunities that might exist. So it's to me, it's leaving our options open. It's taking advantage of a grant that we have received, and it's a fiscally sound decision to make, because there is virtually nothing that could be done to develop that property, to move forward on that property in any way that wouldn't benefit from those utilities being taken down to that entrance road. Dale.
Thank you. I agree wholeheartedly that the referendum was different, that failed. But my point, and I tried to make it earlier, and I didn't even realize it was on the agenda because it was named something different than I realized, is to bring it to another vote. And not just make the decision in this room about what's going to happen to that property, but craft something, a proposal, laying out all the pros and cons, and if the town doesn't support it, not to go forward with it. That's my feeling, is that you guys are supposed to be representing us. And if it doesn't go back to another vote, crafted differently, that we really don't feel represented. I know I wouldn't feel represented. And that's what I'm asking. Before utilities go out there, before bulldozers go out there, before anything goes out there, that there's a clear vision for what's going to happen, and it comes to the town to decide whether that's something we support. That's my strong feeling about that, and I appreciate
Thanks,
having
Dale.
A chance to.
I do feel you're being represented, though, because at least four people sitting at this table were up for election at the time that this was being discussed, and four of us supported the development of the Center for Business and Education. So when you elected Mary Ann, Jerry Sims, Brian Hausch, and myself, you were electing four people who supported wholeheartedly the Center for Business and Education.
I wanted to say two things. One, I talked to Dale, and he had expressed that he had lost some confidence in the council. And I told him, this is a very honest, forthright group of people up here. And I thought it was a mistake to go quite that quick with that decision, because I didn't give people enough chance to catch. When you're a citizen and you're busy with other things, it takes a little time to be involved in these discussions, I think. And so, and I think council members thought the extension of the utilities, it's not about what's happening in the inside. That discussion's still coming. But some people, and I kind of am of that group, that if utilities are being extended, then eventually some development's going to happen out there. Now, I have always, for many years, been against any development happening on that end of town, and feel like we want to stay a small community. And, you know, we're a little village. We want to stay a small village. And you look down the road, and it's terrible development happening down there, and it just scares you to death. But I have changed my position a little bit. And that's where a longer public discourse, I would want to try to convince you that a little development out there, because I'm concerned about the thought that businesses in our community that we love are going to have to move out. And not that we can just keep growing and growing, but there's actually a natural limit to how far we could grow on that end. And it's not that far. So a little bit of development. I think for the health of the village, you know, I've become convinced, you know, for more jobs, for more, you know, to help us preserve the services we have, that a little bit more space for development, and that's that seems to be the appropriate place, would be a good thing. When I talked to people about the referendum and what had happened, I talked to people like Lori Askeland. What did you mean when you came out against that? Did you mean you never wanted to see any development out there? And, you know, people like Lori and other, you know, some people, yes, that is what they meant. And some people, no, that wasn't what they meant. So, but I think the problem is, you know, we have this grant money. I mean, I think we do have some time for discussion before we lose it. And maybe we should take that time to kind of think about, is it important to have some, you know, to have some space so we're not losing some businesses that have been homegrown businesses, you know, that are here. I don't want to go out and look for those businesses out there that necessarily, but for the ones that are here, at least that much, to have a place for them to go. And it can be, some developments can be quite nice, you know, and it doesn't have to be an eyesore on the edge of town. So so I don't know, that I guess I'm thinking maybe we should take a little more time to think about before we try to make a decision on the extension. I mean, we're not going to have a planning process. There's not time for that, right. I don't think. And that's more complicated, and that maybe would be the next step if we made a decision. But maybe we should take a little more time to have a discussion about, you know, I mean, are people who are, I mean, you know, do people feel it's important to have some space for the expanding of some of our homegrown businesses? And, you know, maybe, so I don't know. I don't know how to do that. There's so many things to discuss in these next months.
Can I?
Well, but that's complicated in and of itself.
It's maybe completely out of line, but mm-hmm. I would just point out that throughout the referendum process and throughout the process and continuing, there's never been any move at all to change the zoning of that property and to be aware of what that property is zoned. And it is almost silly not to extend utilities to a property that's zoned PUD. That's
I don't think there's anything nefarious at work on the part of the village to say it only makes sense for us as a village to extend utilities to a property that's owned PUD. That's just my little defense of the village there.
I would just like to say to citizens that anyone who is concerned about what happens out there, if you would email me or contact me, I would like to have a conversation. What I'd like to get a sense of is what the concerns are, other than the fact that you don't trust people on council and that they're going to try and go around. What are the fears? What are the concerns? What is it that you don't want to have happen? I'd like to be able to sort of get those things down so I understand them. Brian, did you?
Do we have other citizen comments?
Dino Pallotta. A couple things that were questioned about as far as discussing and taking time. I think when the utilities, when the water, especially when the water rates are going to go up, you had extensive conversations, if I'm correct, right? There was extensive talk about it, and that we're going to, with the rates were going to go up. When it came time to vote, there was only two people here. Kate Hamilton and myself on the day of, and we both were here to talk about it, see what we could do. That was it. You voted, it was done, we moved on. That's the way it went, that's how it went down. What I'm coming up with, what we keep on going over with the same thing, the same issue over and over, is that you have no place to grow. I've watched Dan Dixon business leave out of here, and I know how much he brings in, what his payroll is, what his gross, what their sales are out of their business. It's a lot of money that we lost. It's just a company that couldn't, had no place to grow. So he had to move to Fairburn, and that's what he chose to do. What I'm saying is we're looking at is that we want to be affordable. I mean, it's a broken record. I go through this every time. We want to be affordable. You're here complaining about utility rates. Well, but there's never a solution. We want to talk about all the bad things, but there's never the solution other than we can't change and we don't want to have business. If we have some kind of business come in there, as Judith just said, some kind of business in there, it's going to make the pie bigger. It's going to give us some tax dollars. It's going to give us revenue to offset whatever programs that we may be needing. And again, this is going way down the road. We're just talking about running utilities now. And I don't know if it goes back to Melissa. Is it a use or lose business by the end of the year for the core? That's what it comes down to seeing is, can we just do that part of it? And then you're able to discuss your open forum to decide what we're going to do, but at least we're in a position to get some kind of growth in here. Because, look, I come to these meetings just like we all do, and we hear the same stories. Utilities are expensive. It's expensive to live here. Renters can't live here. I mean, it's just a tough, we're just, disposable income is becoming smaller and smaller. So we're just looking for an option. That's all we're looking for. And if it works, if we can provide a solution that works with everybody, that's what we want to do. But the pie is not getting any bigger. It's only getting smaller. It's staying stagnant or it's getting smaller.
Thanks, Dino. Anybody else?
Okay. I actually don't have anything different to say than what I said at the last meeting. This decision is purely about whether we use this grant or not. I think it would be very unfortunate for us to throw this away. And the emails that were read, I mean, all those do is just enforce what was already on record in the meeting that I said. And, again, that this is not about what the referendum was about. It's about whether we use this grant or not. I, again, agree with everything I've heard about a in-depth public process about what happens with that land needs to happen. And I'm not ready for that to happen now. And one other thing I do want to add is, because of the work that I do, I know that many federal agencies are pulling these grants back. I'm not trying to fearmonger, and maybe we do have time, but I don't even think that's important here. I mean, it's a pretty simple decision. It's a very small footprint that we're talking about. Two pipes that go down there, no decisions being made. I think this is becoming blurred, illogical, and it's sad. But obviously, these are the kinds of things that get out in the press and make an impact on how people feel about economic development, what we're open to in Yellow Springs. And then finally, these insinuations about, I like nefarious better than evil, are just crazy. And again, pretty sad.
Is it okay
so.
Yeah, I mean, I guess we've decided that we'll keep the agenda as it is. We'll wait for the petition, whatever it is that's going to come in. We'll talk at the next meeting. We'll make a decision at the next meeting how we're going to go forward. I appreciate all the comments that council has made, feel that this is definitely something. You know, Brian talked about that federal agencies are pulling back grants, and we are on a pretty bad track record of giving up grants. And we know for a fact that the county, when we gave up a grant, one grant, we got dinged and didn't get the next grant that came. So we're on track for giving up something like three. We would be on track for giving up three grants. Our grant history with the federal government.
I recall we gave up $1.3 million for funding for affordable housing. And let me tell you, it was hard to get money after that.
Yeah, exactly. And so it's saying something about Yellow Springs not having the wherewithal to move forward on projects is part of what I fear, and I worry about the message we send to our existing businesses and, you know, whether they feel supported and whether people are concerned about their ability to stay in Yellow Springs and continue to do business. So at this point, we'll just leave it for the next meeting. Obviously, we'll have a lot. We'll have, you know, something to talk about then. I'm not sure what, but I think our legal counsel will be busy. Okay, let's move on to the next item of business, community development funding. I'll turn this over to Brian. How much?
I'm going to let Patty take the lead on this.
Did you want me to cover just the special events? Is that what?
Yeah, maybe just kind of give an overview of what we've come up with and give citizens a chance to talk.
Did I miss it? Was there something?
No, just Patty's done some initial research to share.
I lost my primary list, but what we did as a staff, we started with dividing, listing all of the special events that staff is involved in over the course of a year. And this can be anything from the MLK parade to street fair or a Springs Fest or Cyclops or any of these other larger events that happen. And a lot of the events were smaller events that didn't take a lot of manpower or were handled with the people that were on duty. For instance, the MLK parade is always handled with officers that are on duty to lead and follow up at the end of the parade. Other events take a larger amount of time to drop off barricades. For instance, the Simply Women takes a little bit more time because we're dropping off barricades and signs and blocking roads. Then, of course, there are the larger events that are like Street Fair, Springs Fest. Obviously, this coming weekend is a big weekend for village staff because of all the events that are going on that we're involved in. So we kind of divided the, we worked with Brian and we divided the list into special events that were that essentially cost us $200 or less in manpower. These are strictly manpower hours, is all we were counting. We weren't counting the use of barricades or cones or snow fence or anything like that. Then there were larger events that I believe we put at Brian under economic development, and that was Springs Street Fair, Springs Fest, and Cyclops, I think, were in there because they're the three largest. And then we had council-sponsored things such as the Antioch Pool Fill or the Blues Fest this coming weekend and things like that. the Tecumseh Land Trust sponsorship. Excuse me. Then what we did was we took all of the employees that work in the streets, electric and water, or water and wastewater treatment, and the police department, and we averaged their hourly wage just across the board, just to come up with a number, and we tracked the number of hours that were applied to each event and basically assigned a cost. In addition to that, we came up with the cost to replace a barricade, a large barricade, a small barricade, a cone, and also a minimal price to hang large and small banners. And so that's essentially where we've gotten so far. And I wish I could find my master list, but I cannot find it. Brian, did you happen to bring the master list?
I don't know if I have a printout.
Okay. So anyway, that's essentially where we stand as of right now. So.
So are you going to like put that all together as we try to think of how is this all going to intersect with budget?
I think what Patty wanted to do was kind of give us an idea of what they're looking at, and then figure out what would be helpful to council.
Right. Okay.
Moving forward.
So you're still doing that in committee.
Well, yeah, the staff is working on it, and essentially, I mean, we need to know what you want to see at this point on. I mean, do you want to see specifically a number of hours for each and every event? Do you want to know an overall total? Do you want to know, tell us what you want to see, and we can provide you with more in-depth information. We did research as to do other communities support these events outright, or do they charge them? And it's across the board. I think Judy gathered quite a bit of information on that, as did Ruth Ann. And it's across the board. In some communities, they're completely supported by the council and the municipality. In other communities, they're not supported at all. And then there's the middle ground where there's some support, to a certain degree. One of the things the staff talked about was a certain amount free for each event, a possibility of up to X number of dollars free for each event, and then, some kind of a prorated charge after that. I mean, there are any number of things that you can do.
But staff brought this to council, don't you guys have what you want to present?
We do, but then council added so many other things into it, like the special council funding and other different things like that, that we weren't sure how we were even approaching this anymore, because there was the discussion of adding in the things like the Antioch pool fill and the sponsorship of the green space fund and the infrastructure on Cemetery Street and Limestone Street, it started getting all those things added in, which were not things that the staff was necessarily considering. So that was
and the staff, what I'm kind of losing track of, we were trying to address
a lot of the budgets, the staff,
budgets were getting stretched
by the special event, right? And essentially council has any number of options. I mean, you can increase the budgets to compensate for the events. You can make a special fund, and that the budgets gets charged out of that, although I think Melissa says that it's a bookkeeping nightmare to do it that way, and I agree with her. There are any, you can make set aside a certain amount for economic development, and the events can go out of there. There's no set procedure for everything's different. I mean, a special event that comes through my office for an event permit is not the same as a request that comes through council for, say, the Antioch Pool Filler or the Blues Fest sponsorship. So there's no set procedure, and that was something that council seemed to want to address as well. So,
but is the main problem for staff the stretching of the budget?
Yes. Uh-huh.
Because we wanted to link it to the budget.
Correct.
I mean, it feels to me like we're doing a lot of great stuff, and just being actually getting a big list of all that stuff and how the staff and the village supports these all these events. It's pretty awesome, I think. Mm-hmm. So, and you know, we got those nice letters about the street fair, mm-hmm. and which really brought out into the open the what the street fair does for the community. Mm-hmm. So I think the discussion's been very worthwhile just from that angle. So I don't know what to do about the stretching of the budget of the different budgets. But so I think that's been a great thing that's come out of the discussion. These other pieces, and I mean, I kind of always think, well, what's the problem we're trying to solve? If there's not a, so, you know, sometimes citizens come to the council and they make a request. A business does, asks us, you know, can we help fill it? Because we're providing something really great for the village, you know, will you help us by filling our pool? That's an example. Or help us with some infrastructure because we're meeting a goal of the village.
And this didn't come strictly from staff either. I mean, every time I go to, mm-hmm. for instance, to the McKee Group, I get asked to the McKee Group at least once a year, sometimes twice. And one of the things that was asked, and I think, Brian, you may have been there when it was asked as well, was, you know, does council know everything they're spending money on? Because the feeling was council should be aware of everything that you're spending money on as far as the special events. Is that a fair representation of what was
said? There was some concern about the community development spending and just what are the benefits of that. And that's what's important to me about this discussion. Mm-hmm. So I think, Judith, what you're saying, I mean, you know, being concrete about what the village is doing that's so great is supporting that economic vitality, mm-hmm. and I think we need to do that. So
to just make it visible, that's what you're
right. Yeah, I mean, I it's intentional in my mind, and so, you know, I think it's good. You know, a great example is the report that Emily brought us from Home Inc. a couple months ago, where it detailed this is what, you know, those breaks that the village is giving, you know, in terms of utilities, mm-hmm. are generating.
Right, which is another one of the things that's listed on the
right.
council giving away is the homing tap fees.
Right.
And that's why I do think it's important to look at them holistically, because different people have different things that they want to support
about.
Or
yep.
that they feel like the village should be supporting and things that right. they don't feel. Yep. And in order to have it equitable, yep. that it's important to look at it more holistically and for us to articulate what those things mm-hmm. are and the values behind why we're doing a particular thing.
Right. Well, I think there is value in having a list, which it seems like maybe there was, mm-hmm. of the different events yeah. and organizations and activities that we support, having a list that gets updated. I also think it is useful to have a rough sense of how much the village actually spends, both in terms of money going out, but mostly it's staff time, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
How much that is. I mean, I think we should know that. Like, is it $100,000, $200,000, $50,000? And I also would support some kind of system that could say, okay, well, we're going to do this, but we want to be compensated for some of this.
I was going to say, I don't feel that it has to all be one way. I mean, there's a lot of tradition here that we're talking about. You know, the Blues Fest has been here for a very long time, so a certain kind of tradition is around that and around the village's involvement. And the same with the street fair. I mean, it's a tradition. We're not going to get rid of the street fair. That's just not going to happen, I don't think. But I mean, I agreed with what Mary Ann said. I think this is useful to think about, but I don't think we have to come up with one specific way that we are approached to support a particular thing, because it seems like it happens in different ways. And so I don't know what exactly is useful to try to, you know, change. There might be some things, including maybe some things should be partially assisted. I mean, it's helpful to know, like you say, when Home Inc. says, you know, you gave us this, and we generated all of this extra monies for affordable housing that came from outside the village. So this small part that the village gives, you know, helps us bring in a lot of resource to the village from outside. So that's very helpful. And some things, you're not going to ever see that kind of thing. It's just, it's because it enhances our culture, our welcoming, being a welcoming community. But I don't know how to...
Well, I mean, Melissa actually just made a good suggestion. Why don't you...
If maybe, it might be a good idea just to have this as part of, like, a historical record, but, like, in, you know, February or January or something, there's just a year in review, and it talks about all the major projects that were completed within the village. You know, we replaced 2 miles of sidewalk. We upgraded ADA ramps. You know, we committed to economic development by supporting these events. We, you know, supported community development by supporting these things and these requests, and just include it all in one document so it is transparent. And it's kind of a look back at the year and everything that everybody did that might not come to the forefront.
That's the annual report.
Maybe it could be part of the annual report, the year-end report that we do, and just include all of the different categories in there, if that's... And then at that time, council can maybe look at it and say whether they want to do anything differently.
Mm-hmm. But is there some piece we need to do for the budget?
Well, I mean...
It's all already been folded in. I mean, these are all things that we've already done.
They're ongoing,
and the supporting things that come before council, like the pool fill and stuff like that, I mean, those are discussed as they come up in any kind of impact that they would have. But when it comes to staff time with events and everything, we spend that every year anyway, so it's already taken into account.
Okay.
So it's not really anything extra that we haven't been already doing.
It seems useful to me to review it the way you're suggesting and the way we've been doing, in that we might look at something and say, you know, this isn't really something maybe that's, we're getting enough from it. It was a tradition, but it's no longer kind of working or something like that. I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
So in that sense, too, it might be a way of just making sure, you know, as the James McKee group said, you know, to make sure, you know, is this really bringing something good for the village, whatever.
And I think it's fine-tuning just the event process to make it as simple as possible for staff, to make it as clear, I think, and to not have questions, not have inconsistencies.
I absolutely agree with that, but I think one thing that Brian and I talked about a little bit was making it a centralized process for all of it, as far as not only the events that would normally come through my office, but also the requests that would come into council, and making it a centralized thing where everything comes through the same conduit, and council is aware of them as they're ongoing, as well as we could do in the year-end report.
And that does kind of remind me of one thing that Patty brought to my attention that I think is good to know is, times where things weren't requested in advance, so it's required mm-hmm. overtime hours.
Right.
And so I think that's a part of tightening up, you know, this is making sure that, you know, organizations and citizens know what they need to ask for, and then we can plan that in.
Right.
So it happens during the regular working
right.
hours.
Right, because for instance, one thing, and I'm not trying to pick on your block parties, Chrissy, but we had some folks who put in for a block party but didn't tell us they needed barricades, so we didn't drop off any barricades. Then it's Sunday and they need barricades for their block party, and we had to pay somebody two hours to come in and drop barricades, which cost us 2 hours of overtime on a Sunday as opposed to just dropping them off on Friday and picking them up on Monday. So,
and I think a lot of what's happening is that staff has been so eager to get things done and to perform that they haven't been as explicit as they probably should be about what the expectations. Somebody planning an event has expectations of them also, and I think that staff needs to be more explicit about, hey, this is your responsibility and this is our responsibility.
Right.
And if this is a shared kind of process here. So are we, you have direction, so are
yeah.
we ready to move on? Is this, so do we want to summarize what we're doing? Do you want to summarize?
I mean, so from what I've heard, I love this idea of, you know, being as detailed as we can in our upcoming annual report for the village, because I do think that is information that will be good to look at. I would like to continue to explore this idea of how we make the processes better to control any costs that shouldn't be there. And then it sounds like some of those numbers that you've started to put together would be good for some council members to see. So,
okay, do you want any of those numbers in the next packet, or do you want me just, if a council member wants them, they can ask me for them?
I think they should be in the packet. I think having them in the packet is useful.
So just kind of knowing, I mean, for example, that difference between regular and overtime, right, and mm-hmm. what it costs to, you know, have to bring somebody in on a Saturday to put up the blockades or something, just for reference.
Okay. Are you clear?
Yep.
Good. Okay. Judith and Mary Ann have a nomination for the task force.
Our final nomination for the Justice System Task Force is Nia Stewart. She is a junior in high school. She and her friend Ayanna Madison came and met with Marianne and I. They were pretty amazing young people who are very engaged and not afraid to talk, as they said, and just great ideas. I think they're going to be a great asset. And they want to play they're thinking of, you know, some that they may play some liaison role with the high school. You know, to the extent that some of the discourse at the meetings, I mean, they might be interested. They felt there might be some interest in hearing some of the conversation. You know, that maybe we would come there sometime and talk to the high school, or that they would bring input from young people to the committee,
or certainly even invite them to attend the meetings. Obviously,
some of the students,
mm-hmm.
yes. So you know, I was really happy. So I want to make a motion that Ayanna actually is a, what do you call it? She's from Beaver Creek.
Open enrollment.
She's an open enrollment student.
Oh, okay.
But they wanted to work together on this project and perhaps do it as a school project as well. And so anyway, but the nomination is for Nia Stewart, who has grown up in Yellow Springs.
Second
that.
All right.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Next, on a new business, request for authorization to move village funds. Melissa?
This is real easy. So we have money in Star Plus, which is an investment that's issued through the state treasurer's office. So there's Star Ohio and there's Star Plus. We used to have our money in Star Ohio until Star Plus started yielding more, and so we moved our money to Star Plus. Now guess what? Star Ohio is yielding more than Star Plus. Now we want to move it back. So it's a very small amount of yield. Star Ohio is currently, Star Plus, where the money is right now, is yielding 0.4%, and Star Ohio is yielding a whopping 0.5%. So if you're in favor of an extra
thing to move it.
No. So if you're in favor of an extra 0.1%,
okay.
Move the money.
Nowhere to go.
So is this, I mean, you can do this. If we just agree, somebody can make a motion and
I move that we move.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Okay, thank you. And Mr. Solicitor, medical marijuana update.
I think I addressed this very, very high level a couple weeks ago. When discussing medical marijuana, there's three concepts that people have to keep in mind: cultivation, process, and dispensaries. So cultivation is the growing, which will require a license. Processing are the facilities that take the hemp and then turn it into an acceptable, legally mandated product for dispensary. Now, the state methodology is to have the Ohio Department of Commerce to regulate cultivation and processing, The Department of Pharmacy will then handle the dispensing, and I expect that that means that one would get their prescription and then go to a local pharmacy to obtain their prescription, which can be no longer than a 90-day dosage. The law takes effect Thursday, but it really is going to take much longer than that. The Department of Commerce has 240 days to adopt rules regarding the licensure of cultivators, which kind of makes sense. They want to, because it's going to take a while to grow, they have another year, so they're going to add a year or two to the Department of Commerce to create the rules for for processing and dispensing. So, frankly, nothing's going to happen for at least a year. I can't tell you how it's going to look. We can use common sense and logic. We could do a study of how other states are doing it. I read an article in the paper a few weeks ago that the city was doing an RFP, or pardon me, the state was doing an RFP to bring somebody in who has some experience in how to set up medical marijuana programs. There are many states' models that they can follow. I would think that the cultivation will probably be done under a greenhouse model because there's more security, but I don't know. It could be open fields. So that's the overview. Now, in order to get the medical marijuana, it requires the recommendation of a physician. A physician must get a special license, him or herself, in order to be able to prescribe. There are a qualified list of medical conditions that are defined by statute. As I read it, as if the qualified condition is not on the list, then one cannot get medical marijuana, but they can. There's a process by which one can seek to get a condition added to the list. So once the Ohio Medical Board certifies physicians who seek to recommend treatment of patients with medical marijuana, then you can go see that doctor, however that's going to play out. As it pertains to how that might impact a community, medical marijuana, one is it's not smokable. It has to be distributed as an oil, an edible, a tincture, plant material, which I'm not sure I know what that means, or a patch. So if one is walking down the street and smells marijuana because someone is burning it, it is not going to be medical marijuana. And also, there can be no individual cultivation for personal use. In other words, if you are a cultivator, you are doing it with a state license that will be used by a processor to ultimately make its way into the pharmaceutical chain. All patients who seek to use medical marijuana are going to have to register with the Board of Pharmacy, which you think about that. Right now, you get a prescription, you don't have to register anything. You just go get your prescription, get it filled. This is going to require another step. In addition, a physician must certify that they are recommending that conditions are met for a patient who asks for medical marijuana or needs it. Again, I already mentioned that there can be a 90-day supply that's given. Let's see here. Some of this isn't really directly relevant to what a council has to decide, but it's all part of the big picture, because ultimately what really it comes down to is the law is created to give local municipalities significant control over what a community may or may not want in the community, you know, in that area. So if one can zone it out, one can take steps, I suppose, to invite.
Here we are.
Another interesting part is that if you're familiar with a database, that the acronym is ORS, which is the state database that accounts for everybody who's on a medication or gets a prescription. That way they can track physicians who are oversubscribing, or that there's patients who are individuals who are drug seekers. The ORS database is a means to check that. All medical marijuana will be tracked on the ORS system. Now let's talk about zoning, which is really what I would think that concerns the council the most. A cultivator, processor, or retail dispensary, interestingly enough, the pharmacy, cannot be within 500 feet of parks, playgrounds, libraries, schools, or churches. And those are obviously the public facilities. When I say libraries, I'm talking about public library, public playgrounds, et cetera, public parks. So I could foresee, although I don't think this would happen within the village, that a pharmacy that could otherwise distribute virtually every other drug, but if they were too close to a school, would not be able to dispense medical marijuana because of that proximity to the school.
Chris, these things you're saying, have they been decided yet? No.
These are part of the laws that exist, yes.
Oh, these are the laws
yes.
that exist. Ohio has not decided this yet.
No, they have.
This is
the framework by which the medical marijuana will be implemented.
You can also terminate an employee.
Yeah, I mean, so it's not changing the federal law. I mean, it's really kind of so. Why are communities? Am I pushing along? Why are communities? I know that a big discussion in a lot of communities have put a moratorium on anything to do allowing business anything to do with medical marijuana. Well, I'm guessing. I mean, yeah. Is that something you feel that we need to even consider?
No. I mean, not for Yellow Springs. I think that there are a couple different issues. I'm on a couple, you know, group email chats where these topics come up. I think that in some communities, it's just not a good fit because they don't have land that one could cultivate. Frankly, on the dispensing side, we've already got an infrastructure in place through pharmacies that are already established. So it's hard for me to think that, while possible, as I understand how it works in California, for example, they literally created with their medical marijuana things that are generally called pot stores, where they sell it just to those individuals who want their medical marijuana. It clearly would seem that the Ohio structure will account for that and track it through the pharmacy that we already have.
Well, we have this vacant.
We could put it all in one
place.
On the
western edge of town.
Well actually,
and if there's a greenhouse and there's utilities,
that was actually suggested when the article first came out in the Dayton Daily News. Someone came to the council meeting and said that was the perfect use. Yeah.
But is it within 500 feet of?
Do you remember that?
It is. Jeez.
Well, and the high school's right there.
The high school, and you've got
the
public.
Well, the high school's more than 500
feet. If you put it on the edge.
And what I also don't know is I don't know what how many acres of cultivators would want. I mean, there's just so many things that are unknown. I mean, but certainly, when you look at, forgetting about locations of schools, parks, and other things, when you look at a semi-rural area, that's an ideal area where there's already agriculture. For the cultivation piece, and frankly for processing too. I expect that the rules and regs are going to include, you know, means and methodology of expectations of how to track. I know in Colorado, for example, they use a greenhouse model, and they actually put a barcode on each plant and track it that way. I mean, there's sophisticated technology that's available to track all of this. Now, one might argue whether or not that's necessary for marijuana, but that's a different discussion for a different day. But anyway, the new law allows municipalities to adopt regulations that specifically prohibit or limit the number of retail dispensaries. There's means by which it could be zoned out of opportunity. The city has the power to prohibit. Glasses here. Let's see here. According to revised code section 3796.29, the legislative authority of a municipal corporation may adopt an ordinance to prohibit or limit the number of cultivators, processors, or retail dispensaries licensed under this chapter. The one exception to that is, which in theory could apply here, is a municipal corporation may not adopt an ordinance that limits the research related to marijuana conducted at a state university, academic medical center, or private research and development organizations. So in theory, if a local university wanted to engage in some independent research, I think that we may not be able to prohibit that through some type of ordinance. As to the employment piece, which would be relevant to the village, Nothing in the law requires an employer to accommodate an employee's use, possession, or distribution of medical marijuana. So it would suggest that an individual who requires medical marijuana is the result of a medical condition, which would be by definition, would not be, an employer would not be required to accommodate them in the same way they would if there were some other form of disability other than medical marijuana. Did I say it in a way that made sense?
Or not disability, it would, medication. I mean, it doesn't make sense to me, but that's...
So nothing in the new law prohibits an employer from the establishment and enforcement of drug testing policies and zero tolerance policies, drug-free workplace policies, or interferes with federal restrictions on employment. The last piece, I'm sorry, go ahead.
But in that regard, I don't think that that is going to be any different from any other recreational drug or even a prescription narcotic. That we have certain regulations now that say if you're on a certain prescription, you have to tell your supervisor, particularly if you're going to be operating machinery for safety and liability reasons. So I don't think that medical marijuana would be any different from that in that regard. There are certain...
But you can't just fire them.
That's not our policy here anyway.
I mean, if they're on a medically necessary narcotic...
I think that I'll say it this way. The law does not clearly protect one who has medical marijuana.
No, I hear what you're saying, but I'm just saying, would that be the same with a, you know, chronic pain medication? Mm-hmm. So you're on, you know, that's a narcotic, that's a control.
Yeah, that's essentially what medical marijuana is going to be, is a chronic pain.
But it just seems like they're regulating it differently from medications that are much,
sure,
much worse.
Yes.
It's
the mere
just
fact
bizarre.
Is that the person who's receiving a prescription has to go and register that they're receiving a prescription.
I mean,
it's a step.
It is a step.
Hopefully, yeah.
Think of it as a rather
so
stupid step.
So the other part that's relevant when you start to consider how what
or
could
a
this mean?
Block.
Yeah.
What this could mean for the village is that any land that's used for cultivating or processing would be taxed at the fair market value, not at the current agricultural use value.
So which is probably saying, though, that they're using greenhouses, which would be considered
commercial.
More commercial as opposed to actually growing it out, you know,
right,
in the middle of the field. So.
So there's many, many things to explore. I think there was a question about moratoriums. I'll answer that more succinctly. I would think that in a general sense, obviously I don't have any, I'm not privy to what the internal discussions are, but I think that those communities that are leaning towards moratorium would seem to be inclined not to want to have medical marijuana commerce within their communities for whatever their own reasons are. But I think that, and again, some of those places make sense. One, they don't have the land, and they want to wait and see what those rules are as it plays out to the departments of pharmacy.
So it sounds like for us, I mean, I think that we would not be disposed to being opposed, so it's the feeling I'm getting.
Well, I mean, certainly, one of the things that could be done, public lands cannot be used, by the way. So that's something to keep in mind. Now, it's not, I have to go back and qualify this. Federal land certainly can't be used, mm-hmm. and that may apply to federal land because we now have this problem that marijuana is still considered to be a scheduled illegal narcotic, mm-hmm. and we now have all of these states with legalization. So we have that conflict between federal and state law that has not yet been resolved. In fact, there was an expectation, I think about 4 weeks ago, that the administration would rescind that so that there would no longer be a conflict, and they didn't. So that's still in progress. But I don't think, I have to look at it, point being here, if the village owns land that would be suitable for an individual would be interested in processing or cultivation, we'd have to look at whether or not that can be done through a lease or if it would have to be a sale.
But the sale, the land could be sold, obviously, to...
I don't see any reason why it couldn't.
Okay.
We're not there yet.
Yeah, but...
Well, we've got a lot of things to discuss, and, you know, so one of the things that, you know, we could do moving forward with no rush would be to see if they're identified, if council were inclined to do that, to identify properties that might be outside of the 500-foot radius.
Right. Okay. Thank you, Chris.
Can I just say something?
Sure, Chrissy.
This was an idea I had a long time ago, okay? Yeah. First of all, in considering Yellow Springs, our reputation, I think it would almost be an embarrassment if we weren't one of the first ones to jump on the bandwagon and figure out how to make money off of this sort of thing. And one of the best ideas that I have come up with yet, I don't know about the legalities as far as being away from school and all, but the CBE property is 30 acres. I was talking to Karen's husband, Ted, about how much land we would need for a dog park, and he said at most an acre would be fine. I thought, why not look into finding a way to start having marijuana, medicinal marijuana grown on that property, and also take a part of it and make it a dog park. And I just can't think of a better place than a big 30
happy
acres
dogs.
Of nothing but hot plants and puppy dogs.
Yeah.
So anyway.
Everyone would be happy because then they come into town, they could see all the green.
It would be beautiful.
Chris, I mean, I guess now I'm very interested in the commerce part of this. I mean, are people, are businesses, who is targeting this and who is moving in that direction?
No, I don't know. I haven't.
There are some people interested in the village, you know, and not doing it necessarily, but and trying to find the people who.
Right, exactly. And that's frustrating to me that it sounds like, I mean, I think Brian actually did say something about the state blocking. I mean, they are. I mean, they did enact that legislation to keep the pro-marijuana people from putting it on as a constitutional amendment on the ballot in November as a constitutional amendment. So they pushed this thing forward, and now they don't have their act together in order to actually make it a reality, which is frustrating.
Don't quote me on that. I certainly don't know this, but there are, I'm sure that there's a way to find out what the economics of marijuana commerce are. You know, what's the minimum land needed to cultivate to provide and you know, the processing and what the cost of investment is. I certainly know that there are many, many people who are very, very interested because once one obtains the licenses, which are going to be, I would imagine, kind of tough to get, they're probably guaranteed a steady stream of income from that. So mm-hmm. I think that there's people who see lots of opportunity there.
Thanks. Let's see, that's it. Manager and assistant manager report. Start with managers.
We were contacted by AMP about our renewable energy credits, our RECs, on two of our projects, the Blue Creek Wind Project and the AMP Hydro One Project. Previously, the Energy Board had recommended not selling our RECs on any of our projects. Benefit of retaining the RECs would be that, one, the portfolio with documentation, would have documentation that it is in fact renewable, and the advantage of it being documentably green, I don't even know if that's a real word, is that when we're applying for grants, it would be an advantage for us. There's a minimal dollar advantage to selling the RECs, but overall it would translate to about $8 a year per individual, a benefit to the individuals in the village. So the recommendation of the Energy Board and the staff still stands to not sell the RECs, but I just need to know if that is still how council wants to proceed.
I had asked, Patty brought it up to me, and I did ask her if there would be, with the increase in utility bills, if there would be a significant impact on individuals, and it sounds like it's not significant enough, and what the benefit we're getting
from keeping them
is important. So I would certainly support it. Mm-hmm. I make a motion that we continue to keep our RECs.
Second.
Yep.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
The Touch Truck event, while it got cut a little bit short because the weather did not cooperate with us, was still fun. I had a great time. I was serving hot dogs all afternoon, and there were kids running all over and having a good time, and it was a pretty fun time. Melissa was there, Judy was there, a lot of the staff were there for the folks to meet us, and the kids had a great time climbing on dump trucks and garbage trucks and police cruisers and whelping the sirens, and so it was a really good time. And the last thing that I really have is that there was a question, I think, about Brian had asked me to check and see how much energy we were actually spending in the two electric car chargers that are out there. You have to know that, first of all, it would cost us $20 a month per unit if we were to charge. The actual unit that you use to charge people for plugging in there would cost us $20 a month per unit, so that would be $40 a month. And in the month that it has been out there, the two chargers have been out there and people have been using them pretty consistently, we've used 109 kilowatts, which is totals $11.99 that the village has spent on the two electric car chargers in the past month.
That's all.
That's all.
Mm-hmm. And they've been being used a lot.
They've been being used very regularly, and I got this read this morning.
Wow.
So it is up to date. And it's been just at a month since they were actually put into actual use. So in 1 month, it cost us $12 for folks to charge their vehicles out there.
And maybe Dewar could figure out how much carbon we're saving by allowing that to happen.
I'm sure he could.
And that's all I have.
And actually, maybe we should survey those folks since they get to charge it for free to see what they're doing in town.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, how much money?
Well, maybe we should put like a parking meter thing there, not a, you know what I mean?
Mm. Or a donation? We could put a mm-hmm. we could put a donation thing there.
That's a good idea.
Could you find something? I mean, something.
Yeah, that's a really good idea.
Suggested donation.
Yeah. Mm. I'm sure that people wouldn't mind.
Yeah.
Melissa.
So we covered just about everything that's already in my report except for the last thing, which I'm super excited about. Denise and I have been working on getting ADA compliant sidewalk ramps in the village. There's quite a few that still need to be upgraded. We were focusing on Xenia Avenue and West South College, and we had submitted for an MVRPC grant last year, which we were denied because we'd lost a grant from them. So we went to Greene County for a community development block grant, and we presented to the county commissioners, and we actually were awarded that grant. So this is $26,000 to complete 16 ramps along Xenia Avenue from Limestone Street to West South College. So this is awarded in 2016, and we have to have it completed between April and June of 2017. So that gives us the textured domes, domed ramps on the sidewalk. So we'll get 16 new ones.
Great.
For $26,000. And we shouldn't have any match because we'd already paid previously for the engineering for all of the ramps in town. So.
Okay. And Melissa, can you just clarify when you said we lost a grant before with MVRPC?
Mm-hmm.
You mean
we gave it back?
Well, I don't know what happened because it was before my time. It was the Northern Gateway.
It was the
though.
Northern Gateway
yeah.
that we gave back.
We returned the grant.
Didn't move forward on the project. It was one of the ones I was mentioning.
So
but
yeah,
it was because there were match. There was a lot of
there was a, oh there was a reason.
I mean,
but
there was a reason. It wasn't that.
That's always the reason.
It wasn't anti-development.
Yeah, no, no.
Like
that's
that.
it was just a more expensive project.
And we had a lot bigger, much bigger match.
We expected, yeah. Mm-hmm. Good job, and thank Denise for that also.
Yes, will do.
Yeah, very good job.
Judy.
Just, it's been super busy. We have a lot of public records requests, taking up a lot of time and energy. And then I've gotten assigned a different area with OMCA, so I'm really happy about that education committee, which is a lot of fun. So I'll be out a couple of days in the next few weeks to do those things.
Okay. Future agenda items, September 19th, we see what's there. General fund budget, that'll obviously take some time. Just our first look at it. The fiber needs assessment, we're moving forward, at least we'll have in the packet the the resolution about the extending the utilities, and then also the design-build contract with Shook. Moving forward, we have another budget session in October, two more budget sessions in October, and then by November 7th, we'll be looking at the final budget in totality. Anything that we need to add or?
We do need the ordinances will come back. I'm sorry, I put them up.
Oh, all of the zoning.
Come back real quick, and yeah. I just thought I'd float it past as to whether you would be interested in starting at 6 or 6:30 on that one, because you've got a hunk load, it looks like, for that meeting.
What's council's pleasure?
You're talking about on the 19th?
Yeah. And you don't have to decide it now either. It's just looking like that's going to be a very long meeting again.
But you might as well, because getting hold of everybody is going to.
Well, I would lean against it, because it's going to be hard for me to get here at 7 already.
Okay.
But that's just me.
Well, I just think citizens don't pick it up. Item they want to be a part of the discussion.
This will move forward. The zoning ordinances sailed through, so we would be into this other legislation that I think there's going to be a little bit more interest in. So I would agree. I would feel a little bit bad to have that. So we'll just keep it at 7. Hopefully we'll get through. Hopefully we'll be able to get through it. We've got some play on the schedule related to the budget. I think we can. You know, we always used to schedule special meetings, so if we can mm-hmm. do this all within our regular agenda, that's always good. Okay, sounds good. So the zoning ordinances, that was it. So I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
I move.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Thank you, everybody. Mm-hmm.